enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Let's do that.
Yeah.
Morning.
Why?
Good morning.
And ain't it a fine morning?
Oh, it's just lovely.
Yeah.
Why get the flu shot if it makes you fluey?
Oh, did you get one of those?
Yeah, I'm feeling fluey.
Where you go? The pharmacy?
Yeah,
did you
CVS.
Go to like CVS?
To the old CVS.
Have some fucking just scrub, give you a shot.
Yeah. It's like the flu shot has been great for me over the years.
Yeah.
The last five, I think I started about 5 years ago. But I'm feeling just slightly fluey. Nothing bad.
Isn't it supposed to do that?
Yeah, sometimes. Or it gives you a fever for a couple days.
I got the fever.
But this is in place of the all-out flu.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's nothing.
Jimmy comes in just makes a catastrophe.
But these water bottles are broken.
They're the worst water bottles. The bottoms are like fucking...
I don't know what happens. Like,
all bulged out and they fall over.
They try to put too much water in water bottles?
No.
I can't remember.
They bought the cheapest fucking shit water at this place.
Water's water.
It isn't. That water.
You want to do a water test? You wouldn't know the difference.
I'll tell you, yes, that crystal geyser.
I like the crystal
fucking
geyser.
It doesn't. It's not as good as the Poland spring water that I bring from my home.
Mm-mm.
We used to have that a little over a year ago, but then they switched it out for.
How about we do a water test? I guarantee you don't know the difference.
Look at how it falls. I've literally just tried to push my water bottle.
I know it happens.
Broken. It's toppling over like Humpty Dumpty.
What the fuck happens?
I don't know.
The pressure changed or something? Something's
amiss.
So just slightly fluey.
Yeah, a little fluey. A
little ache, a little fever. I now call it the fever.
When you get the shot?
Sunday.
Yeah.
Late Sunday.
I can't believe I ever went without getting it.
It's amazing.
It's amazing.
In the end, it's amazing. I mean, by what? Tomorrow or Thursday, I'll be fine. And that replaces what would have been a 2-3 week nightmare.
I've never gotten one.
You should.
Never gotten one.
Well, you don't get sick like me. I don't fucking get that shit. It must be alcohol or something.
Kills everything.
I don't know.
About once a year, though. Maybe once every 18 months, I do get a pretty good cough, cold thing going. But it lasts maybe 3-4 days. And then that's it, you know. I don't know.
That Tim Conway's a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Was that great?
I broke that down all day yesterday in my mind.
That was a lot of fun.
And, yes, I hid yesterday. Absolutely. I fucking
hid. Did you take shelter?
Well, I didn't know, like...
Good for you.
I was trying to find an inn. I didn't have one yesterday, so I didn't want to force my shit. And then I'm like, you know what? I'm not even going to look at the guy, because he's just looking around the room to just be an asshole to someone else. And I was thinking, yeah, it was funny and all. But I think he's an asshole. I really think he might just be an asshole.
He loves fucking with people. Oh, my God.
But even off the air, he was doing the same shit.
Yeah.
But here's why he was okay. Because he enjoyed being teased.
Right.
You could tell Tim Conway, he liked the back and forth.
Yes.
And he liked being made fun of.
That's
too.
Old school comic
stuff. Like, he really enjoyed being smashed.
Like, I can only imagine him and Harvey Korman off TV.
Yeah.
Right.
Going back and forth. There must have been brutal shit going on between them. Yeah.
That really is old school, where it's just cutting humor. You don't see it as much.
Yeah.
All you have to do is go to a family function and your older relatives try to do that Tim Conway shit, but they're not Tim Conway, so it really fucking
it
hurts.
Comes off as mean.
Right.
Or it's dementia.
Not, right. There's not many laughs in there.
Yeah, yeah. I heard off the air he was doing some pretty funny things, too. What was that, Sam? You were talking about yesterday when somebody was saying going to the, like, his publicist or something asked if he had to go to the bathroom, and he goes, "No, my bag isn't full yet."
Did he really say that?
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, and he kept making her think that he had Alzheimer's or something.
Yeah,
and she was like, "You remember this building, right?" And he goes, "No, have I been here before?" She goes, "Yeah, for with Carol Burnett," and he goes, "Who's that?
Who?"
Oh, that's great.
That's just who he is.
Who's that?
It's fucking funny.
He did something. Did you catch when he first walked in? He walked over. He said hello to you, and he said hi to Ant.
Yeah.
And then he just kind of stood behind Anthony for a second, and I'm like, I know he's doing that to be a, like, he was,
to be an asshole.
To pretend he didn't know where he goes.
Right,
but you weren't sure at first, and then you realized, sure. Oh, man, this guy's a dick. That would be exhausting, fun, though. I think he's one of those guys that doesn't turn that shit off.
No.
Yeah, probably not.
So it's fun to do, like, a half-hour interview and get beat up. But he probably just walks through life like that.
I thought it was great. And judging by the feedback from listeners, they loved it.
He
was
enjoying it,
just
that makes
just brutal.
That'll great. Make the podcast
a lot of fun.
When the feedback is way over the top on something, we throw it on the podcast. Yeah. That one we'll make it next week.
And Regan fucking jumps in with a question. He's like, and then when he got shit on, he's just like, all right, I'll just sit here now.
Tim goes, who's this?
Yeah.
Who's this?
And Regan is like, he is huge in the comedy world.
A premier American
comic. Conway
comics,
just was like,
yep.
Fuck you.
That was fucking funny.
It was fun, though.
He was really fun, man. Because he just, again, if he didn't laugh and have fun when he got smashed,
he
I'd be like, what a douche.
Yeah.
But he seemed to want to really take a little bit of abuse.
Absolutely, right? Yeah. Yeah, that's a sport for him.
Sure.
That was good.
Well, it's another day.
Yes, it certainly is.
That's yesterday's show.
Yeah, that was it. Everyone, all the news stations are, like, talking about Superstorm Sandy, which was a year ago, I guess.
Right?
They're,
A year ago, me and Jimmy were downtown watching that water rise.
Yes, we were.
That's some scary shit. You go to the tip of Manhattan, Battery Park, and you see that water rise in front of your eyes. Remember,
and
it started coming over the shore?
And there's nothing you could do about it.
Yeah.
And then eventually it went down into the subways and all that. Yeah. We were there
tunnels,
with all the weather people.
And that guy zipping around on the fucking jet ski.
Yeah, just enjoying the waves.
Crazy shit.
And the news people just couldn't believe that someone would be out there. I'm like, he's so close to shore, and he's jumping waves. What's the big deal?
This is very dangerous. We do not recommend you come out here.
Right.
If you don't have to leave your home, stay. Okay.
But they were amazed. Like, a hurricane is slowly moving toward us at that point.
Yeah.
He sees some really cool waves, and he's going to jump on his jet ski and enjoy his
day.
And then news people, I don't know what it takes to do something like that.
Yeah. Superstorm Sandy, and they're looking at a year ago and what was damaged and how far they've come in the cleanup and everything else. So
I think in general they've done a pretty good job. I know there's people still suffering and people still living in hotels and whatnot, but considering
Seaside
what
Heights.
Happened, holy shit!
Seaside Heights got pretty fucked up, and Jersey Shore, fucking Long Island, South Shore. I went down there recently, South Shore, Long Island, and everyone's driveway just has those construction trailers parked in their driveways.
Yeah.
Just blocks and blocks of people still trying to get their fucking houses together.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Well, Godspeed, everybody.
Yeah, Godspeed. At least
Godspeed, everybody.
At least it's looking like, not quite. We'll have a Halloween this year, because last year the little kiddies, Halloween was pretty much canceled last year.
All right.
Pretty much canceled. What's the matter?
That was in my wheelhouse. I had to walk around my neighborhood with my kid. It was deeply depressing.
Yeah?
Yeah, because we go to Philly because it's very homey down there for Halloween.
Literally homey.
No,
No. Oh, I see what you mean.
But it's a very, it's a cool neighborhood to trick-or-treat in.
Yeah.
Everyone comes out, there's a few beers on the stoops.
Ooh.
It's nice.
Yeah.
And last year we were just in... I mean, I think there's one street on the Upper West Side that allows trick-or-treating or something, so everyone goes there, and it's just a complete and utter nightmare. Just imagine, like, thousands of people in one block of the city.
Yeah, that's...
Maybe two blocks of the city.
That's annoying.
It was really annoying.
You're going to Philly this year?
Yeah.
For the old trick-or-treats?
That's why I'm going to miss your party, and I'm going to miss Jimmy at the Beacon.
The big party.
It's a big weekend, and I'm going to be out of town.
Oh, yeah.
It's more fun for a kid to go house to house, I think.
Oh, yeah. I actually enjoy it, too. It's kind of cool.
I think going around and seeing people walk. Something about walking through the neighborhood, it just feels like it's a weird reality when it's Halloween.
Yeah.
Like everyone's wearing weird costumes. It's like in your building, it just doesn't feel have the same.
Riding the fucking elevators. Yeah.
I forgot. Thank you. That's how unforgettable it was. We actually did trick or treat in the building last year. Something I thought I would never have to do.
Yeah.
Because we did the crowded street. That was shitty. Then we came home, and then we walked the floors. It was so. Oh, my God, these city kids. I got to get my kids out of here.
Yeah, they got to be raised in a nice suburban setting.
They're going down stairwells from floor to floor, and some of the floors were set up nice where they, like, turn off all the lights and make it a little spooky.
But did they do that?
Some did in my building, but most were just like...
Oh, the elevated door opens and some guy, oh, look, it's a little ghost. Right. Oh, hello.
We're knocking on doors and coming out, and it's just like, it's not the same. It's not the same of kind of, remember growing up with those shitty plastic masks, you smell your own bad breath, your hands, because it used to be cold for Halloween. Remember you would almost feel like you were getting frostbite on your fingertips?
And the snot would run down your nose, but you couldn't wipe it because you had the dumb plastic mask on.
And then you did the intel because someone would go, hey, man, we've done this break, but it's worth almost doing every year. Hey, man, they're giving out the good shit, you know.
Good candy.
And they would give a number.
Full-size Milky Ways.
And then everyone would run there, and of course they don't have them anymore.
Yeah, so you have to throw eggs.
Right.
And fuck up the poor old lady's house because she ran out of candy for being nice.
Of course you have to.
I like giving Lorna Dunes. Those are a marvelous cookie to give to a child.
Just fucking busted up sand on the bottom of some kid's bag.
I just don't. I mean, we're going into hack material, but I don't understand why they make candy corn. Who eats that?
Yeah, it's just disgusting.
Everyone tries it because it's around, and it looks like it should be way better than it is.
Waxy, it's flavorless horrendous. Shit.
How are they in business?
I don't know. You can't give away
How
that.
How are the
shit.
Candy corn people in business?
Just go. You know what? They make so much good shit now.
Really good shit.
You can just go to the store, buy bags and bags of little mini fucking...
The Mary Janes, the candy corns.
Mary Janes.
Another horrendous
Old
candy.
Is that?
But the bit is a little different this year. It's like
wrapped in parchment.
Right. Why the fuck are they still making those candies? Yeah. No one likes them.
No.
I don't understand.
Yeah, they still fucking... I'll hand them out.
I'm going to throw one out there. It might be a little controversial.
Uh-oh.
The Tootsie Roll.
Yeah, I don't know. People still digging the Tootsie Roll.
I don't dig a Tootsie Roll. Never.
I don't know what it is. It's not chocolate.
Do you like a Tootsie Roll?
I'll eat a Tootsie Roll.
Well,
I don't necessarily like a Tootsie Roll.
I think that's
roll.
How their business is getting by. People will eat a Tootsie Roll, but they're not enjoying a Tootsie Roll.
I don't go out of my way to get a Tootsie Roll. I'd rather have a fucking, you know, a nice piece of real chocolate.
Right.
I don't know what a Tootsie Roll is. Is it supposed to be chocolate?
I don't know, but if you
The fuck is it?
But if you go in a candy store, you're going to pass up everything else to reach for the Tootsie Roll?
No.
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 Of course not.
Tootsie Roll. What a dumb name, too. You can tell how old the candy is by the name.
Toots.
Hey, Toots. Some old fucking gangster was being shit on by a flapper back in the 20s. Hey, look, a Tootsie Roll.
Good old Halloween. That means Thanksgiving and Christmas. How does that happen?
I know. This is
Wasn't I just on a beach making trifecta. Fucking holes for fires?
I hear you.
Fuck.
It goes pretty quickly.
This time of year especially. It just is one after another.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I'm not a fall kind of guy.
No?
No. Fall is for people that are like, you know, I like waking up early, getting out in the brisk, crisp weather. Ah, you inhale that brisk, crisp, cold air. Fuck you. I love the heat.
I like to change the seasons. For
no, not, no.
I laugh at everyone on Facebook that says, oh, fall is my favorite time of year.
Yeah, shut it.
It's everyone's favorite time of year.
Not me.
I'm talking about the masses.
Summer is king.
Summer's the shit.
Fucking outside, it's light out late, you're grilling, you're fucking drinking outside, it's just great. Then fall comes around and fucking close up everything. The landscapers came yesterday. It was like they were making a fire break in my yard. They cut every piece of vegetation down.
Why?
Because that's what they do. They cut everything down and fucking haul it out of there. And now it just looks like a barren, shitty backyard that I got to stare at until spring.
Why do they cut everything down?
I guess that's what they do, just to make way for...
Just keep everything healthy?
Yeah, keep it nice, and the next year it all grows back. Oh. But, yeah.
The sugar daddy.
John, remember the that's another old school fucking...
I think I've been
fucking,
called that many times.
Yeah, hey, sugar daddy.
John of Long Island.
Ugh.
Yeah, remember the sugar daddies? Then they used to get so hot and sticky, and you'd peel it off, and the paper would stick to the sugar daddy. But you ate it anyhow.
Yeah, I mean...
They were like the best. I love them things.
Oh, you like the sugar daddy?
I loved them. They were great. They were
you could pull out three fillings in one bite with a sugar daddy.
And possibly a tooth.
If you try
a whole fucking tooth.
Yeah, if you put the sugar daddy back by your molars and bit down on it,
yeah.
It wasn't coming out without ripping pieces of your fucking teeth, gums, fucking... You could do your own root canal with a sugar daddy. Fucking horrible. I don't know what it's made of.
Yeah.
Concrete.
Call up with your favorite candy, everybody!
Oh.
Time for Halloween! Oh. Bah, bah. All right, brother.
Have a good day.
All right.
Yeah.
Let me try to change it up a little bit. I'm just amazed some of these fucking candies are still in business. That's all.
Yeah.
That's just my dumb little point.
I mean, Jesus. I remember trick-or-treating and getting, like, some horrendously old candy.
Mm-hmm.
And we've talked about that. The wax... bottles filled up with the colored liquid.
What's the
like, you don't even know what it was. It looked like a little six-pack of soda bottles,
right?
But they were wax, and you bit the top off and sucked out this
old school,
this red dye number five cancer agent.
And then you just chew the wax like it's gum.
Yeah, chewing wax.
That's what us poor people did because we couldn't afford the gum.
The wax teeth.
Yeah.
You put in the wax teeth and then eat it.
That was dumb.
The wax teeth. You put it on. It was big lips and fucking wax teeth.
Right.
And I always go, hello, howdy there. Yeah.
What about that mothbally candy?
The malted milk.
Malted milk, yeah.
God, that shit sucked.
I would just continuously pop those in my mouth, though.
Really?
It made a unique crunchy sound. Yeah, it was very light and airy.
And why didn't our stupid generation, you know, discover dark chocolate?
We had the cheapest chocolate ever. All cheap chocolate.
What was the problem with the people around us? They didn't understand that dark chocolate is pretty fucking tasty.
I just wanted regular old chocolate, and you bring out this gourmet shit.
I don't like dark chocolate.
I love
it's too
dark
weird.
Chocolate.
It's just kind of weird.
Especially when they mix it up with a little shit, a little bit. I'm working on a caramel one right now.
Yeah, that's fine.
With some
peanuts.
Sea salt.
A little ghetto, but I'd like your basic flat, dumb Hershey bar.
Yeah.
You know?
True.
A weird little texture.
What about the Junior Mint?
Ooh. It's delicious. It's very refreshing.
I can only have like two or three.
Yeah.
It's kind of obnoxious.
I like a good Junior Mint.
Do you?
It's a Junior Mint. Yeah.
Was that Kramer?
Yeah, it's very refreshing. That's when he flicked it up to give it to Jerry, and it flipped out and went into the guy having surgery, and actually cured one of his ailments.
Mm.
Yeah, it was a fun one. The Junior Mint.
I'm trying to get rid of a 20 plus year coffee habit.
How's that working out?
Probably because that's probably why I'm feeling flu-y, by the way. Because if you look it up online, man, trying to get off caffeine is a motherfucker. And someone suggested green tea with brown rice.
The fuck is that?
Probably because you're vomiting and you don't think of drinking anything.
That can't possibly be a good alternate.
So I've been drinking like Starbucks green tea, which I just don't like. It makes me fucking nauseous and shit. So,
yeah.
This is horrible. How am I going to get off coffee? I'm trying to find something I could drink in its place.
Wait, that's green tea.
Green tea with brown rice.
Wait, what?
Roasted brown rice.
Roasted brown rice?
Mm-hmm.
In the tea.
Yeah, I guess in the tea bags.
All right, that's crazy now. Now that's just some crazy shit.
Someone says it tastes much better than just regular green tea.
What's wrong with...
Coffee? Oh,
no, what's wrong with, like, regular tea? Still caffeine?
I don't feel like feeling my fucking veins every morning anymore. Too much coffee over the years.
What about decaf?
Decaf coffee?
Yeah. Have some Sanka.
That might work.
Sanka.
But decaf coffee just blows. You can tell the difference. I don't know.
Some of that taste is choice.
But getting off coffee thing is brutal.
Yeah.
It's fucking brutal. I knocked it all the way down to one tiny small cup of coffee a day. I used to do 4 or 5 huge fucking cups a day.
I'll enjoy a good espresso with dinner, but...
You're not a coffee drinker. You're lucky.
Not a coffee drinker whatsoever.
You are lucky, my friend.
Like a little tea with honey when I'm feeling a little under the weather.
Yeah. Maybe honey will jack this shit up. Mm. Isn't honey a superfood?
You know, honey is pretty good shit right there.
I got turned on to peanut butter and honey sandwiches this summer. Oof,
okay, no.
It's fucking pretty damn good.
Honey's weird with bread.
Pretty damn good. You put it with some peanut butter. They were made for each other.
By the way, I don't know where people are getting honey these days because there are no bees left. I don't know what happened. That's another thing I remember from my youth. Do you remember in the summer?
I'm laughing. The line's hilarious, but your face. That's why
I'm horrified.
That's why we got to have a visual.
I'm horrified.
Like you just saw a ghost.
When you were a kid, and I know you know this, by any trash can in the summer where kids are throwing their Coke cans and fucking cake and shit like that.
Their ice cream.
There would be
that, right?
A fucking mob of dangerous bees.
Right.
Buzzing about the garbage pails. City streets even on the corner during the summer. Yeah. Again, dangerous bees everywhere. Now you don't even see them buzzing around your garbage.
When you do see one, you completely freak out because you're not used to seeing them anymore.
Yes.
Yeah.
Again, my backyard during the summer is very, very flowery. Lots of flowers and fauna. And nary a bee to be found.
Really?
Yeah. They doing their old pollination thing.
They say the bees are going away because, yeah. What, the cell phone towers or something?
Is that what that,
I thought they didn't finally, know. Oh,
they're finally starting to figure it out. Supposedly, it's the cell phone towers are fucking up their shit.
Wow.
Confusing stuff.
I have no idea what it is.
Not good if we lose the bees. You know that, right?
Bees are pretty important.
Worse if we lose phones.
The ecosystem. Yeah. Yeah, fuck the bees if it becomes between our phones and bees.
That was part of being a kid, too, just battling the yellow jackets.
Battling
and
bees.
And the bees and whatnot.
You were in a constant battle with fucking bees trying not to get stung.
Remember the floaty wasps? I call them the floaty wasps, where they had that extra part and they would just kind of hover.
And their legs would swing back and forth. Their giant legs hanging down. They were frightening.
You would take a yellow sting, a yellow jacket sting easy. Oh, that wasp shit.
I was petrified.
Would scare the stung. Fuck out of you.
I was petrified of getting stung by anything.
You got stung as a kid, right? We all did.
Oh, yeah. And boy, I swear, the screams I would let out when I got stung.
The worst.
Running home.
The worst.
My father would, of course, call me a faggot and tell me to, you know, put some ice on it. And then I'd have to run to mommy, you know, because she would give me a little sympathy.
She would give you a tip.
He got stung by a bee, Joey. Fucking bee! Who gives a shit, bro?
Jesus, you're just a kid.
It was my summer. But as a kid, it was like you were battling monsters in your yard.
Right.
It was a monster that could hurt you.
Absolutely.
Fucking bees. And now...
they're going away.
They're not even around. I don't know what happened to them. Godspeed, bee. Godspeed.
We used to catch them in jars.
Oh, yeah.
I'm so afraid of them now, but when I was a kid...
You would catch bees in a jar.
I would catch a jar and like go down to the grass. And I remember we would see who could get the most bees randomly in a jar. And I remember I got 43 into a jar because I kept thinking the next one was Reggie Jackson's number, 44.
Oh.
And I couldn't get the last one.
Did it bother you?
I don't remember if I got it or not. But
now, were you the guy that would catch the bees and the top of the dandelion in the jar at the same time?
Yeah, sometimes had to.
No,
it was a wasp.
No,
or whatever.
I wouldn't like any flora in my jar. I wanted just bees.
Yeah, reach in and pull it out then. What am I tell you?
No, you had to wait till he flew up a little in there. Clunk, clunk, clunk.
No, it was hard to do when you had a jar full of bees.
That was part of the fucking intrigue of the whole game.
I don't think we did bees. We did fireflies.
Oh, they can't hurt you.
You can catch them with your cockhead.
Cool, run around the yard with a jar full of fireflies, and then you got bored and put the jar down, and next morning they're all dead. Just a loser fucking kid that doesn't have any awareness yet.
How horrific is that for the poor bug? Like, what happened? I was flying around.
Dome. What about killing an afternoon just burning fucking ants?
Burning ants or any other bug with a magnifying glass. Like a big giant monster.
Just being a fucking unaware idiot.
Yeah.
I saw something online with these Japanese hornets that we've all seen.
Oh, yeah, a guy who, crazy.
But this guy makes this potion out of them. And he's like one of these 80-year-old Japanese guys who's fearless. And he was just standing like where these Japanese hornets were. And he was catching them with this net. Just like no mask, nothing. Just, net, catch bee. These fucking, these thumb-sized hornets. And he had a jar of honey, and he takes the hornet, and he opens the net over the jar of honey, and he taps it until the hornet falls into the jar of honey. And he would get like six or seven of them from this little mini, cluster of them that was floating around.
I would assume they would die in the honey.
But they slowly suffocate, and they can't get out. It's really kind of cruel.
Of course it is.
But it makes like this elixir or something in Japan.
To make their dicks hard.
Exactly. It is one of those dumb things.
Of course.
And he said
so they get pixelated out in pictures.
Some of them take 10 hours, they said, to actually, before they will give up fighting to get out. And then you watch these things struggle.
Right.
And you actually feel bad for these shitty hornets.
Yeah, you shouldn't do that to any living creature.
Just flick its head.
It's me. Yeah. Cut its little dumb fucking head off. Its little triangular fucking head.
Let's go to Max. He wants to talk about the phone towers and bees. Oh. Max.
Hey, how's it going, guys?
Hey, Max.
Taking my call.
Yeah.
I was working on cell phone towers in Ohio for a little bit there, and when you're up in the tower, it's just swarms and swarms of bees. They're attracted to the RF signals.
Maybe they're up there, and they get radiation poisoning and die.
Yeah, then what happens?
Mm. I mean, probably about 400, 500 feet up in the air, just swarming the towers. They build nests up there. It's insane.
Oh, no. They build that. That must suck for you guys.
Oh, man.
Oh, it's terrible when you're trying to change out an antenna, hanging over the edge, getting attacked by bees.
So, wait, where would the bees, like, if the antenna's hanging over the edge, where would they nest?
Up there we got pipes and platforms, so it's basically just like a house almost. So it'll just be all over there.
Wait, you're not scared of heights, obviously.
I was.
400 to 500 feet in the air, huh?
Jeez. Yeah, it's pretty intense.
Holy shit.
Pretty fucking
crazy.
Scary job right there.
Did you get stung?
A couple times. My foreman was up at 1,200 feet, and there were bees up there, too.
So what did, how do you get rid of them, or do you smoke them out, or what do you do?
We didn't really have anything to counteract them up there.
So you're just working with in a bee nest? Fuck that.
Yeah, just go up there, kill some time, come back down, and go, okay, I took care of what needed to be done.
Yeah.
You go check.
Get yourself a can of Raid.
Right.
Go up there with some Raid. We used to have to do that in attics when we were working, and there was a bee's nest in the attic you were working on. And you'd go up there with some Raid and just start spraying it at the nest, and the bees would go crazy for a little while. Oh, scary.
Oh, no way.
You're in a tight, confined, hot space with the bees. Oh, nasty.
I love those fucking, remember years ago it was just regular Raid, and then they designed the wasp can?
Yeah.
Which was like a fucking fire, I guess because they realized that you're getting, you're 8 inches away, something's going to get to you.
Yeah, you could go pretty far away, and just that stream would come out of that funnel-shaped nozzle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tsunami of chemicals.
I work in like an anti-aircraft gun, you could track them as they're flying. Oh, it's a lot of fun.
Great weapon, too.
Yeah. His face.
You want some bee stories?
Yeah, I love bee stories.
Sure. Man.
All right, let's go to Dutch in Connecticut. Dutch.
Hey, buddies. Being a typical kid, we had a nest like just under my sister's window in her room, and I thought I'd help my dad by spraying them. And I tried the Raid thing, but then I found like if you light a match, like hairspray, I thought that would help. And I hit the hive, and next thing I know, it kind of started catching the house and the garage. And my dad was a defense instructor in the Marine Corps, Anthony.
Yeah.
You know, your dad looked like a fucking saint, all right? When I had to go explain to him that the house was on fire, it didn't go over very well, to say the least.
Nah, I wouldn't say. Those fucking bees nests, they're made of paper. What are you doing? Of course it's going to catch on fire.
it just seemed to make sense. It was
paper
like,
and wax. Beeswax in there. That's like a fucking flammable combination right there.
It's a flamethrower. It's perfect. They're coming out. They're flying out of the hive on fire. I feel pretty good till I look up. And my sister's room, like, the flames are starting to come out of the room, and I got to go tell my dad.
Yeah,
that's wild.
Punch it out, boy.
All right. Bye. Thanks, Dutch. Let's say hi to Darren in Texas.
Hey, what's up, guys? How are you?
Hey.
We're just kind of chilling out, talking about bees.
Talking about bees. Well, there's a... I just moved to this total shitneck little town in the middle of nowhere, Texas, and apparently everybody here in this town is some form of beekeeper. And they collect all this local honey, and I know they distribute it or whatever, but everybody in this town is like a bee wrangler.
Yeah, I guess there's beekeepers and stuff, and that's where the honey and shit comes from, but it seems like the wild bees are just not as numerous.
No.
Not as plentiful.
Well, they're definitely not as prominent, but they are talking about how our planet is supposed to be, you know, repollinating itself.
Oh, yeah?
So they have plans in place, but the bees are never going to fully go away.
Well, I hope not.
Well, we knew a guy.
And this has been a thrilling topic, Jesus. And I know you really right, exactly. The fuck out of my conversation this morning.
Well, we knew a guy who had bees when he was, and he would he had hives and stuff. Yeah. But there was this one cruel kid that he would bring his stupid cart of honey jars around. And this guy just took his honey jars and dropped them on the ground and broke them.
Oh, that's very mean.
Yeah, it was very mean. They make a thug, a dull, thick thud.
That thick fucking thud of the honey jar busting open on the ground.
Hey, Tuma!
Tuma! Tuma got his.
Boy, did he. He made Red and those guys come to his house, and then he fucking yanked the beehives, and they all got stung.
Yes. They weren't very happy with that.
Well, you got the Red Sox one game away from the old World Series there.
Win, 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 win.
What are you talking about?
What?
What are you talking about?
Well, I'm talking about the Red Sox.
One win away from winning the World Series?
Yeah.
Sox go boom. Playoffs now. Valentine fired, fans cheering loud. Fenway Park, Big Poppy. Play is back with Gomes and Napoli. Pitching staff with leftist K's and a bats go pow, pow, pow. But there's one sound
that
we all know. What does the Sox say? Win, 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 win. What does the Sox say? Beer, 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 beer. What does the Sox say? Green, 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 monster. Green, 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 monster. Green, 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 rawr. Green, 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 monster.
Wow.
There you go.
Fucking hilarious.
Wow. What an awful... Oh, why did Boston have to go so far all the way to the World Series? Now they could wrap it up with one more game.
It's those creepy beards. When did they start growing them?
That is really fucking stupid. They look like Al-Qaeda. They look Amish.
Now they're shaving their heads on top of it.
Fucking... It's just a...
It used to be a playoff beard. When did they start? Like last year they started growing beards?
Yeah.
Those beards look like a year old, right?
They look like degenerates. I like a good team, but like the Yankees, all nice, well-groomed.
I like the beard thing. Look at that shit.
Fucking...
They ain't fucking around. Look at that.
Steinbrenner used to tell those boys, you keep your hair fucking tight. And none of them beards.
Holy but shit, we're looking at pictures.
They fucking just look like filthy hillbillies.
What happened? When did they decide? Does anyone know?
I don't know.
Because that's not just a playoff
pretty
beard.
Quickly.
I don't know. That seems like...
Yeah, they must have started at the beginning of the season at least. No, that beard's got to be fucking...
Yeah, that's a beginning of the season
that's
beard right there.
That's ridiculous.
Right?
That looks like fucking 2 years. That guy can grow a fucking Saint Nick beard. That's young Saint Nick. That's Kris Kringle.
And then, of course, you got to shave your head after you got the big beard.
Oh, God.
Do you find it fun when they do the crowd shots and people have the fake beards on?
Fake beards on.
Ew, do they?
Yeah, that's a thing. That's a thing now with Boston fans. It doesn't look like old St. Lou has a shot here, huh?
I don't think so.
Going back to Fenway.
Going back to Fenway. And Boston only needs one.
Is it 3-1 or 3-2?
3-1. It's bad. That's bad, right?
You know how I knew they lost again? Because I follow Geezer Butler on Twitter, and he lives, I think, in St. Louis, which is a weird place for Geezer Butler to live.
Right.
But he was tweeting about the bloody Cardinals, and that's how I knew that they lost.
There you go.
I follow my baseball through fucking a British basis.
Yeah.
That shows you how far removed I am from sports.
Yeah.
Speaking of sports, you got Troy Aikman being called a queer.
This is
being called a queer.
This is great audio, by the way. I listened to this yesterday. It's not even so much. Now, who called him a queer?
Dexter Manley.
Dexter Manley was on a radio show and calls him a queer. And it's not even that. That isn't even the highlight. The highlight is the utter and complete fucking panic that sinks into the rest of the show.
Right.
The people that are
What show was this on?
It's just some like AM, I think, talk show in DC.
Yeah. They fucking go into defensive apology, groveling, trying to separate themselves mode instantly.
Well, is Dexter Manley part of this radio show?
No.
No.
Who gives a fuck?
He was a frequent guest.
Do you know, I was like, I listened to it, and I listened to their groveling, and I got annoyed. But then I was like, you know what? These guys are in a bad spot because you're afraid your gig can get taken if you don't immediately.
Oh, I don't blame the host.
That's just it.
So I wasn't annoyed at them.
I don't blame the host, but it's...
Like if they would have laughed or something or, you know.
Right.
It's like, uh-oh. Who said that? Who said it? Who laughed? Who was in the room? We know. We've been through that.
Let's hope that they'll recover on Sunday when they play against the Chargers. Maybe it was an AFC team or something. I'm hoping that they can redeem themselves come Sunday.
Wasn't a big jinx that Troy Aikman was doing the game, the former Cowboy?
I think Troy Aikman's a queer.
Hello.
Phil.
Oh. I think Troy Aikman's a queer. First of all, what is Dexter Manley even thinking?
That he played against him, he probably knows.
Yeah.
He thought he was going to get the room laughing on that one.
Does he not understand the fucking climate we live in these days?
Yeah, but it's that whole...
I mean, but he should know, because if someone dropped an N-bomb in front of him, he'd probably lose his fucking mind, a white guy.
Ex-ball player, dude. He's not paying attention to that stuff as much.
Oh, you know God. What
I mean? I don't think he means queer in the dick-sucking way. Anyway.
No, probably not. He's probably a joke. I think he did, but he's probably just joking, like... he's a cocksucker.
That was probably a real rumor, because there's always been rumors that Aikman was gay, and he probably believes it, but was saying it in a ball-breaking way.
Is he married?
I don't know, but I've heard for years that people thought he was gay.
Wasn't a big jinx that Troy Aikman was doing the game, the former Cowboy?
I think Troy Aikman's a queer.
Hello.
But he gets his name wrong, Troikman.
I think Troikman's a queer.
Troikman.
I think Troikman's a queer.
That could be the best part, his name. Troikman.
Oh, boy.
I think Troikman's a queer.
Hello.
Hell.
We don't want to go there.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Now, do you want to apologize to him?
No.
You don't.
I'll just say I take that back.
Okay.
Since he's a Cowboy fan.
Right. Well, we don't want certainly anyone to think that anybody endorses anything like that, Dexter. Because that is, you know, really not an area that we want to go in.
Okay. I apologize.
Dexter, always good to see you.
Yeah, good. Thank you.
Thanks for coming. Get him right the fuck out. That's it. Dexter, good to see you. Get the fuck out. Don't ever come back.
Yeah, I mean, they have to do that as hosts.
Yeah, they do.
And then the...
They cover their asses, because your bosses do not protect you anymore.
No.
They just let you fucking...
Yeah. As a matter of fact, the station put out a statement saying that he will never be on the show again.
It's amazing. Like, what fucking cunts. Like, the guy said queers joking. He said he was sorry. Like, he's just a football player joking around. Like,
yeah, yeah.
We can't differentiate between that and a guy truly being hateful?
No.
God,
no.
What a dumb country.
Not anymore. It's done.
We would have Dexter Manley on in a second.
I would love to have Dexter Manley on.
Sounds hilarious with that. Truckman.
But by the way, that's to me. Do you see how that was handled?
Yeah.
And then you look at the way they handle the Redskins with the with the fucking name. Oh, we ain't changing it. He says queer. Gone. Gone.
Supposedly, yeah. The Redskins are meeting with the NFL.
They're gonna change it without a doubt.
They're gonna fucking fold.
Yeah, the Bravehearts.
Ugh.
That
is just fucking disappointing.
What's another choice they had?
I said the Washington. Oh, Colin, I want to spit on him for thinking of this. He's been tweeting the Washington R words as the Redskins. The R words. Oh, it's enraging.
Oh, we got something on Dexter Manley now. Let's say hi to Tommy. Tommy.
Oh.
Hey, what's going on,
Tommy,
boy?
Salami.
Hey, no salami here. Just was hanging between my legs.
Ooh, delicious.
I was going to say, on the Manley, wasn't he the illiterate player that couldn't even read, but he's called someone a queer? It sounded like Dexter Manley was queer when he said it.
Whoa.
But you know what? Easy. If he is illiterate, then maybe he's just not reading the paper and paying attention to the
fuck?
Climate.
Someone like Dexter Manley doesn't need to read.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He's a standout in his sport. He has so much money, he could have someone just fucking read for him.
Did he play for a college?
Redskins. Oh, yeah.
Did he play for a college?
Oh,
and
wow.
He can't fucking read, right? That's
why he could play and make the money, but he lost it all. Well,
we all know what goes on with the student athletes, so.
Yeah.
War is bad, it makes me sad.
That's not right. War is bad, it makes me sad. Fucking millions of dollars.
Carmelo Anthony.
Yeah.
Let's say hi to Chris in New York. Chris.
Hey, Chris.
Hey, good morning, boys.
Hey.
Y'all.
Boys, check it out. Listen, you got it wrong on the World Series. It's the best of three right now. They still have three games to play. And it's anybody's game at this point. God forbid these big, ugly animals win this game. The series.
The fuck are you talking about?
I know what you're saying. It's kind of a cliche.
World Series.
Yeah.
Yeah.
World Series. They just played four games. They're even.
No.
What?
Red Sox need
one game out.
Red Sox need one win.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
The Red Sox are up 3-2.
Yeah, we all know
three
that.
3-2. You said 3-1.
But it is 3-2.
3-2 is different.
But it is not 2-2.
Did I say 3-1?
Yeah, that's a big
they
difference.
They won 3-1 last night.
Oh, okay. 3-2 is
okay, but the Red Sox still need one game.
Yes.
Oh, I was in a coma. I missed the whole goddamn game. But anyway, fuck that big monkey David Ortiz. Goodbye.
All right, bye. I say that, I apologize.
Jesus.
Yeah. No,
still,
I know.
I mean, college time.
I know it's 3-2. Let's say hi to Mike in Jersey. Mikey!
Hello there, guys.
Welcome.
Good morning, Mike. How are you?
I'm good. Anthony, you got to keep up the good fight, buddy.
All right.
What's that mean?
You hate the colored. Mike hates the colored.
No. Just hate Obama. Okay.
The liar? The liar in the White House?
What do you got, Mike?
Crooked, corrupt liar. Dexter Manley signed his NFL contract with an X.
Did he?
Yeah.
Look, he didn't sound like a genius. He thought he was going to say Troy Aikman is a queer, and the room was going to erupt with laughter.
Yeah.
Troikman's a
but
queer.
But there's no difference in our country between telling a joke that doesn't work and true hate speech. That's how fucking stupid we are as a country.
Same category as somebody that would prowl the streets at night looking for a gay couple and punching them about the head, neck, and chest.
Right, we should be able to... You know the difference.
Yeah.
Even though he apologized right after, and it was like, you know, because that's how ball players, and he released an apology after to Troy. And I'm sure, you know, Troy Aikman, if you asked him, he'd go, all right, fuck it. He said he was sorry, let it go.
Whatever. But he signed his contract with an X. That's great.
The apology is repulsive.
He played for 11 years. After failing a fourth drug test, he was permanently banned from the NFL. And then revealed he was a functional illiterate, despite having studied at Oklahoma State for 4 years.
Boy. That doesn't bode well.
And now he's going on the radio and calling people queers.
Queer.
But, and everybody's upset.
And he's laughing after. He's queer.
Yeah, he loved it.
The whole, hey! Yeah. Watch out.
And they go, do you want to apologize? And there's a pause, so he thinks about it, and he goes, no.
No. No.
Not taking it.
You know what? We got to hear it again. Fuck it. It's too good.
Let's hope that they recover on Sunday when they play against the Chargers. Maybe it was an AFC team or something. I'm hoping that they can redeem themselves come Sunday.
Wasn't a big jinx that Troy Aikman was doing the game, the former Cowboy?
I think Troy was a queer.
Hello.
Hell.
We don't want to go there.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
Now, you want to apologize to him?
No.
You don't?
I'll just say I take that back.
Okay.
Since he's a Cowboy fan.
Right. Well, we don't want certainly anyone to think that anybody endorses anything like that, Dexter, because that is, you know, really not an area that we want to go
in. Okay, I apologize.
Dexter, always good to see you.
Good, thank you.
Thanks for coming in.
Get out.
It's so cartoonish that it should be okay.
He's probably like the show's Bobo. Like, it's a sports show, right. So they have to have a football player on, but he's also an idiot.
He's just an idiot.
All right, let's
Troikman.
Let's say hi to John. John.
Hey, John.
What do you got, buddy?
Well, I'm still watching the Redskins changing their name deal.
Yep.
I believe that Daniel Snyder is such a piece of shit that he doesn't give a shit if it's Washington Turdholers or whatever. But he's got to put up this big. It probably won't be. But he's got to put up a big shit stink about everything. And then when he finally, I guess I'll change it. But think of all that merchandise that he gets to resell to all the people that. Like the Washington Redskins.
You're right, but with a name, this is a big one for the fans because you're right about merch. But dude, this is a name that's been there for so many years. This is one that even though you'll make merch money, he doesn't want to lose the Redskins. It's one of those fucking, you know, it's just one of those ingrained football names like the Cowboys, and the Giants. Yeah. Like he doesn't want to lose that name.
It's sad that it's gonna happen.
Yeah, I get it. Yep.
All right, John, thank you.
Thank you, buddy.
But, you know, the satisfying part for me to see it change is simply because this is the climate that people have allowed to take place.
Yeah.
Like, what happens is this is a big noticeable one. But all these years, when guys were getting in trouble and guys were getting scolded, no one stood up. Like, nobody out there. People would be like, and then slowly they fucking creeped up on you, and they creeped up on you, and you can't say this, and you can't say that, and you can't say this. And now that it's one of your teams, all of a sudden people are like, whoa, what the fuck? Where the fuck were you 5 years ago with your outrage and your letters? Where was that?
Yeah.
You brought this on yourself. You asked for it by saying nothing.
Yeah.
I just don't I don't feel like when they came up with the Redskins that they were trying to get away with some kind
probably
of slur.
You're right. No. They weren't.
From the beginning, they really thought that the name Redskins was a very positive thing, especially
powerful.
For their football team.
Yeah, you're right.
I never felt like they were, oh, look what we got past everybody.
Yeah.
It's annoying. It's annoying to live in this world like this with this bullshit.
But the way they reacted to
shit.
To queer. Look at how they reacted to queer.
Oh, boy, like, did they freak out.
It's too arbitrary. It's like you're either going to let people tell jokes and be there or you're not. It's fucking just arbitrary, and the outrage is here one day. It's like whack-a-mole. Good. Okay, no, you can pop your head up here and say that. That's fine. The next day, dead. There's no way to gauge it.
We lost that one a while ago. It's the same fucking thing. You might as well take a brick and go find, you got to be careful. Someone on the street, because it's the same thing that will happen to you. You'll get crucified for either, you know, saying the word in joke form or actually doing something to somebody that might be that.
There's no context anymore.
No,
of course not.
It's just whatever it is. It's like everything you say is written down on a transcript with no sarcasm or humor to it or anything. They just take it literally and verbatim and hang you with it.
No difference between gay bashing and hate speech and just telling a little joke on the air and then go, oh, sorry. No
little joke. Humor.
Let's go to Sean in Texas. We got more on Dexter Manley. Sean.
Morning, fellas. Hi, yeah, when poor Mr. Manley, you know, he played 11 years in the NFL, and I'm certainly not busting his balls, but I walked into a furniture store here in North Houston a couple years ago, and he's trying to sell me a couch and love seat. He was in there, you know, busting his chops, selling furniture, so he had nothing after 11 years.
Yikes.
All his money was gone. He wasn't, and come to find out, he wasn't smart enough to manage it and didn't have the tools to manage it. And for selling furniture and recliners.
Oh.
And then he had a nice little radio gig. Now that's
now, he can't even be on the radio anymore.
He sounded entertaining as all hell with that.
Everyone's petrified of having him on. He might say, Troikman's a queer. Troikman.
Troikman. All right, Sean. Good thank morning. You.
Thank you.
Let's get Dexter Manley on the phone. That's
crazy.
Let's say hi to this guy. Who's this guy?
Yellow.
I don't know your name, brother. It's not on the phone screen. I'm talking to you.
Hello, brother.
Do you hear my voice? Yeah, you. What's up?
Oh, boy.
Hello. Just say, everyone say hi right now.
Oh.
Sorry, I had you on speakerphone.
Okay, buddy.
Of course.
You have Dexter Manley's phone numbers.
Yeah, he did a benefit for
Mr. Kite
for my football team, and I got his number in my phone.
All right, hold on a line. Maybe we'll get Dexter Manley on. Take that guy's number, call it, and see if it's Dexter Manley.
Yeah, he's selling furniture. We should see if we can get him a job.
Yeah, see if he wants to come on our show.
Hire him here.
Sell some furniture.
All right. What do we got today? Oh, Mike Baker's coming in. I saw his show.
Yes, on JFK.
He's part of America Declassified, which is on the Travel Channel. And we're looking at 50 years since the JFK assassination.
50 years.
So he went down there to Dallas, Texas.
Ah.
And conducted a couple experiments.
I like a good JFK experiment.
He truly believes that it's a conspiracy.
He does.
Yep.
Am I a smart, analytical guy? I'd be very interested to hear what he says, because he may have a good way of looking at it. He's not a dumb guy at all. He's a very bright guy.
And he could probably kill somebody with, like, one finger.
No, I don't think so. No, he's too nice a guy.
Yeah?
Probably shoot you.
I bet he's got,
yeah,
like,
those are the guys
you got to
worry about.
Maybe.
Some covert shit where he's just snapping necks.
Are you saying I just know happy fucking Fox News, Mike, and I don't know the real Mike?
Yes, exactly.
One twist that
comes up behind someone and just does that thing where you put your hand on the back of their head and their forehead and you go, fwah! And just snap their neck. He drops them slow, puts them on the ground, not even looking at him. He's back to looking forward, and then back ahead.
Right.
For the next guy. That's Mike.
He got access to the railroad watchtower down there.
Oh.
And I don't think anyone has ever had access to that as far as, like, people in the media and
off
stuff.
Limits.
Because one of the witnesses swore they saw smoke from the grassy knoll.
Mm.
As in, you know, someone firing, and then you get the smoke. So he did that experiment, and he was able to go to the watchtower to see if the guy could have possibly seen the smoke from the grassy knoll. So
he believes conspiracy, and I know Jim Norton from our many conversations about this, the Kennedy assassination, has come back around. Who? Bugliosi?
That was the big part of
the Bugliosi book.
There was other things I read online which helped, and a lot of the photographic, like little weird things, the conspiracy theorists have, like, hey, that little, is that a figure inside the grassy knoll, black dog man?
Yeah,
all these weird little names, and the conspiracy theorists know who I mean, or the umbrella man, and all these things that did have explanations. Or when you hear somebody go, those tramps, the three tramps they arrested, they never identified them. They absolutely have identified them.
A lot of people get their history from the movie JFK, which had a lot of...
That's what bugs me. When I hear people quoting things that I know for a fact are nonsense, you know, Oswald was a terrible shot.
They told him to stand down.
He wasn't a terrible shot. He was a sharpshooter. Like, these fucking... that's when I know that they're just believing a quick thing that they heard.
Yeah.
But hey, look, I'll be interested to hear, you know, I'm not married to the idea that it was just Oswald. I don't give a fuck. Oh. If it was a conspiracy, I'd be more than happy to come around back again and go, you know what, it was a conspiracy.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, the conspiracy theorists have proven themselves too irrational to me.
Jim is wishy-washy.
I wasn't there, so I'm willing to listen to both sides.
How many witnesses died in an untimely manner?
Not many. And that was something...
Because that's one of those things people bring up and they go, the odds of that...
Yeah.
The odds of it is so ridiculous and off the charts that that's what makes people go, you know, go, oh, wait, I got to raise my eyebrows.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe some of them, but not what they said. And again, Bugliosi addressed that in his book, and it was just more paranoid fucking nonsense.
What do you say about that?
That they just, it wasn't true. Like, I forget, it's been a couple of years since I read the book. I should probably go over it again since I talk about this shit all the time. It's a fucking 1,200-page book that he hand-wrote.
Oh, that's rough.
Isn't type.
Ah.
Wow. That's a lot of work.
And they type, it's brilliantly cross-referenced, and he goes over every conspiracy theory.
Wow.
200 pages, though?
Yeah, it's a long one. But, I mean, it's so many...
Can't do that shit in 200 pages?
Thank you for your service.
All right. We're going to take a break.
We also have Aziz here.
Yeah, Aziz is coming in today.
He has a special coming out on Netflix.
Tariq? Tariq Aziz.
Oh.
He's the,
the information minister of Iraq.
Not to be confused with Baghdad Bob.
Good old Baghdad Bob.
Still one of my favorite people in a war ever.
Yep.
Everything is okay.
His bombs are going off behind the guy.
The Americans did come to the airport, but we pushed them back, and we are in control of the airport.
You know, behind him, you're just seeing C-130s fucking conga lining into Baghdad.
People screaming, running across the screen.
That guy was a hoot.
He was awesome.
I think I still have a coffee mug with his picture on it.
Really?
Yeah, I had to have a little memorabilia from Baghdad Bob.
Also, Jimmy Kimmel, in a little trouble.
What did he do?
We're going to tell the people next.
Oh, a little teaser-oony.
And then we'll get an update on our favorite person, Jay-Z.
Oh, Jay-Z.
Is he still in the hell nah stage?
Jay-Z, Barney's. Now, you're partnered with them. You're making a lot of money. Are you thinking about withdrawing your relationship from them due to racial allegations that...
Is there anyone there? Go.
After these messages, we'll be right back.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
Not a big fan. Sorry. Thumbs down for the Opster. Yeah, not a huge Beach Boys fan. There's a couple I like.
But they're okay.
This song is 51 years old today. Surfing Safari was their debut album, I believe.
Let's go surfing now. Everybody's learning now.
What year was this? 53?
51 years ago. So what would that be? 62-ish?
Oh, 62. See, I didn't love them either. What was your wedding song that was actually really good?
Music. God Only Knows.
That's a good song. Yeah. I like that one a lot.
Can we hear that, Eric? I like that.
But in general, I'm not a huge...
You know, I'm tearing up. I'm not going to tear up when I look at you and hear the song.
You might. No. Oh, that's a good song.
Reminds me of Boogie Nights.
Paul McCartney called this the best song of all time.
Did he?
No. Really?
Well, he doesn't know shit. Was Paul though?
This is the end of kind of a Boogie Nights where they're all kind of showing what they're doing after their turmoil.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
It's one of the few songs with the use of jingle bells doesn't make you think of Christmas.
Ah.
There's a lot of jingle songs.
Yeah.
Using the jingle bells.
Like this?
Yeah.
Lobbing.
All right.
Yeah, it's worth to hear a taste, Eric. What are you fucking going on vacation now?
He's in mourning.
What? What? Sweetie.
Leave Eric alone. He's in mourning.
Lovey, what's the matter?
He lost a Simpson character.
He's so upset about Edna?
Oh, he's absolutely upset about
it. How'd you lose it?
Eric.
Well, she died, so he's like...
He's in mourning. Oh, ugh. Cares.
Nah, he cares. He'll tell you.
She only did the one voice.
Really?
I do the voice of Homer Simpson.
Do you?
Holy
shit.
Wasn't she also the receptionist on Bob Newhart?
Yes.
Yeah, that's how we know her.
Yeah, that's how, like, real people, real cute adult human beings know her.
That's how old people know
her.
Whoa! Wow.
That's
point
right.
And angle.
Exactly. Because The Simpsons hasn't been on for 30 fucking years.
Exactly. That's a really old show now.
Come on.
How many years officially?
We're in the 26th season.
Holy shit, really?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
What else can they do with
longest
a cartoon?
Longest running non-scripted primetime show, I think, right?
Is it still happening?
Or scripted, excuse me, non-scripted.
I can't believe people still watch new episodes of it.
I can't imagine.
Are the new episodes good?
Not like the first 10 years, no. But they've gotten better from
10 years ago.
Is it on TV still?
Yeah.
You know, everywhere. I've never heard.
No, I know. Like, I've seen the reruns, but new episodes are on TV still.
No
huh?
one Sunday talks about it.
It's not like a
no
web
one
show?
Says, did you no. see The Simpsons last
well,
night?
Well, no you used ever. To sit down in front of your TV on a Sunday after football and watch a little Simpsons.
Oh, yeah.
I don't feel like people are doing that anymore.
No.
Mm-hmm. But it's just there, but it's one of those things that they'll probably never get rid of. It's too, they're too, what am I saying?
Iconic.
Iconic, yeah, and I just lost interest.
I know, it's like, I can't get up for a Simpsons discussion.
Man, I heard E-Rock's like giving away part of his fucking toy collection. I heard that
Why?
On Sam's
Y'all
show
right?
yesterday.
What's wrong with
a lot of scoops?
Oh,
what's going
a lot
on?
Of scoops yeah. on the Sam Roberts
I'm
show.
I'm just focusing on certain things, and I have too many toys that are from too many lines, so I'm just going to start getting rid of
what
all
happened
of it.
At home.
How, yeah, how yeah she exactly. Get,
believe me, this is not a voluntary.
Oh, no,
no
way.
It is.
No.
It is.
No.
It is.
What are you, growing up?
No. I'm just focusing on certain toys, not rather than
he's running
everything.
Out of room. Why would you? Why not just keep them? Put them in a
Do
box somewhere.
Do you have to
somewhere?
Get a baby room together? Is that what's going
oh,
on here?
Oh shit!
Oh shit! Congratulations, E-Rock.
There it is.
Got his wife pregnant, having a baby. Congratulations.
Because I used to have a room that had all my stuff in it, and then you know, I had to box that shit up and make a baby room.
Yeah, why don't you just box it up and put it in the attic?
Yeah.
It's already
storage
boxed up in the basement.
Well, then why are you getting rid of it?
Because there's too much.
He keeps buying more.
Don't fight him. He's trying to be a real person, and we're encouraging him to keep his hoard.
I just don't believe his sincerity
no,
in getting
I'm
rid of these toys.
On
I feel like there's something else going on.
That's it.
Two lines.
Yeah.
He's getting rid of Transformers,
oh.
He-Man,
Voltron.
Good.
Voltron.
Voltron.
Yeah, the shitty ones.
He-Man's the worst.
He-Man.
That cartoon sucked fucking balls.
Do you have He-Man toys?
Animation was so bad.
It was. It was horrible. Filmation.
Is it worth money?
Some of it was terrible.
The company.
Some of us were children when the show came on. So.
Doesn't matter. I was a child when I watched cartoons, and it was done artistically. Amazing.
That's what? Right.
Composed music just for the cartoon. Fucking not just the cell of the fucking mouth moving over a matte fucking drawing. It was art.
But you had to go to theaters to see them.
No.
No.
The television?
It was on the television.
They weren't part of the newsreel?
Not part of the they might have been when they first came out.
Yeah. The Flintstones house was very realistic when they ran across the entire house.
Flintstones animation wasn't that good either.
What?
That's the
Flintstones
for sure.
Stunk. Hey, Bonnie! Oh. Shut up.
I love the Flintstones.
Hey, Bob.
Hey,
Fred. I'd watch the Flintstones over the Simpsons any day.
I liked the Flintstones.
And now, you asshole, and I'm pointing at you.
Oh, no.
I can't watch Family Guy anymore because of your fucking take on it.
Fucking stand that goddamn show.
What? Reminds me of that time.
That reminds me of the time I was in the Foreign Legion. But all right, there it is. Now go to the... There he is. Oh, okay. Ha, ha, ha. Now he's back again.
And then they come back for 30 seconds.
30 seconds.
It reminds me of the time.
That's like when I was giving a speech at Nuremberg. And
I think it's overused.
It's fucking angering watching that
god-awful
fuckwad show.
My young son is a big fan of the Family Guy, though.
Yeah?
Yeah, he likes Family Guy.
Oh.
That's why I've been watching a lot, and that, but your observation kills it for me.
It's like that time I was walking on the moon with Neil Armstrong, really? There he is, Peter in a big fat spacesuit. It's always it's the entire show.
Reminds me of that time.
Reminds me of the time. Wow. Right. Wow. Does it? I can't stand it.
Is there anything you like these days? I'm getting confused.
I really, I've been reading a lot of tweets from people that are very concerned that I don't like anything.
I know I don't like a lot of stuff. But...
I just voice what I don't like.
Are you looking for new cartoons to watch?
What would you suggest?
Any suggestions?
I would suggest Archer on FX.
Archer on FX.
What's Archer?
Like I saw some promos for that. It did seem kind of funny.
The Top Gun trailer that they did?
Yeah, yeah. It looks kind of funny.
Very funny show. Very risque.
But I like live action stuff these days. I'm digging a good live action.
Yeah.
Well acted. You know, kind of real adult movie.
Like a person.
Like yeah, I don't watch adult cartoons.
Why?
I have no interest.
Because he's not happy.
That's not true.
Oh,
you can't enjoy your
E-Rock fire and back.
No, but that's not true. I am, and I enjoy good fucking...
Adult cartoons are great.
No, they do nothing for me. Oh, maybe it's because they annoy me too much on principle, because I know that they're getting away with more than real people can, and that just makes me...
Yeah.
It's not their fault. It's,
yeah, that's true.
But I never really got into them.
I was a big fan of Robot Chicken. Are they making new episodes?
Yes, they are.
Yeah.
I like Robot Chicken. I'm going to have to delve back into that shit.
Yeah, it might be great.
Quick and easy. Yeah. Pop culture. Gets a beating. Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
I've probably seen two full episodes of The Simpsons in my life. I've never seen a fucking episode of Family Guy. And it's not because they're terrible. It just annoys me too much that people can't say shit anymore and the cartoons can't.
Eric, you watch Adventure Time?
I haven't in a while.
That reminds me of when I was on the Hindenburg. Oh, look.
He's still at it.
He's fucking jumping out. It's on fire.
We did this already. It's
God,
okay.
I can't fucking handle it.
But to be fair, they have acknowledged it in this past season.
I saw it.
I think because they finally, heard everyone bitching about it.
I saw the episode because he goes, that reminds me of the time, and it's some ridiculous thing, and then he goes, can we have a clip?
Right.
Well, no clip?
There's an episode where they go, like, a couple of the characters go back in time to the pilot episode,
uh-huh,
and they're watching stuff goes on. And they're watching the family in the kitchen, and they'll say something, and then they just stand there, and nothing's happening. And the other two characters go, what the hell are they doing? What's wrong? And they're like, oh, wait, how many damn cutscenes did we have in this episode?
Okay.
And then they do an episode of just all cutscenes.
Well, acknowledging it doesn't mean that,
no, it doesn't mean it's going to stop it.
It doesn't suck.
But at least they're just letting you know, okay, we get it.
I hate it.
Look, I can accept the fact we're not going to have flying cars.
Yeah.
But can we figure out a fucking plastic spoon that doesn't cut the shit out of the sides of your mouth?
You could put a man on the moon.
How are you hurting yourself with the spoon? I'm having the same spoon.
Are you kidding?
Zipping around in here, eating, laughing.
Why does it have to have a razor blade edge?
That reminds me of when I worked at the plastic spoon factory.
Why?
They don't do a good job deflashing the plastic after it pops out of the mold.
No, probably because it's too much time and
they
money.
Need to throw those in a big dryer thing fucking with some sand or something and sandblast them.
Cut the side of my fucking mouth with this thing.
Gem alert.
Whoa. Kenny just walked up to the mic. Jimmy's calling a gem alert.
Is this brand of oatmeal acceptable?
No,
as
I hate it.
It's a little better than the Starbucks, though.
I hate it. I'm bringing in my own oatmeal starting tomorrow.
Kashi?
No. I don't do the Kashi as much.
I swear to God, those are the most unhealthy, ugly people in Kashi commercials.
Yeah.
There's not one attractive person in those commercials.
No.
It's some girl, she's walking through the jungle looking for some leaf to put in the cereal, and she's a fucking dog.
She's shaking from the lack of protein.
Of course. Fucking translucent skin, right. She's never in the sun.
Right. But she's going to find that unique berry for her next cereal. Great.
I find unique flavors for Kashi.
She's got the natural graying hair coming in. Color that shit.
You know what? I'm usually with you on that.
Yeah.
The other day, walking the streets of Manhattan, there was a woman that walked by with natural gray hair.
Yeah. Looked good.
Wow. Yeah.
Really?
I was surprised.
Was it long?
It was, yeah. Yeah. Not like...
Is it lustrous?
Yeah, it was full and it was gray and it was like...
Yeah.
It worked. I want to say yes, that it's working on you.
Could you run your fingers through it?
Yeah. I was surprised because usually I'm with you.
Yeah.
You know, dye that shit.
Hmm. Was she old?
I was trying to figure that out. Probably, no. Probably, I mean, old for you, yes.
Yeah.
Very old for you. But I would say probably, if I had to guess, like mid-40s.
Yeah?
Yeah.
That's not, that's nice. I don't care.
There was a little bit of a turn-on.
Yeah.
A little bit.
I don't know.
Nah, it wouldn't turn me on.
No,
I could live
no.
with it, but it wouldn't turn me on.
I know.
There was something about it.
It always reminds me of some fucking country naturalist woman thing.
You're not a fan
long
of that?
Flannel shirt. Hair. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, she cares for horses.
Where she's working her garden?
Yeah, shit like that. She's gardening.
Working the public garden.
She has her gardening board that she puts out to kneel on.
Right.
It's got the little holes for her little spade shovel and that little claw thing.
Nothing better.
I'm gardening.
Nothing better than driving through a neighborhood and seeing a big fat pearl, pear ass bent over working on the garden.
Bent over gardening. I love those commercials where it's like for health care or some shit and some old woman's gardening and the husband is talking to her like he gives a fuck about a dumb plants. That doesn't happen.
I don't understand gardening.
I don't either.
People
as
really,
a hobby.
They really get into it.
It's something you have to do if you need to do it.
Horrible.
You know, oh, we need some vegetation in front of the window here.
We used to have to pull weeds out from around our house. I hated it.
Yeah, but
there's no fun in it.
Yeah. People with empty nest syndrome, I think. A lot of older people.
Oh, is that it?
Now that their fucking womb has a for sale sign on it. They're out there like, I want something to grow and feel like I'm giving some kind of life.
And what, they notice what's growing overnight? They're like, motherly... oh, we got some new stuff growing over here.
Care for it. Talk to it.
Nurturing
love it.
Nurturing something. Yeah. Raising it.
Yuck.
You're right, Jimmy.
Sprinkle some water on it. Give it care and it will love you back and nourish you.
Walk in on it while it's masturbating.
Yes. Yeah, so those tomatoes won't overdose.
This rhododendron won't come home with a Negro.
Exactly. Yeah, this cucumber is not going to go into this zucchini and disgrace the family. Yeah. Or I should say the tomatoes won't be spoiled by the eggplant.
Yes, exactly. wow. Yeah, I don't get that gardening thing either.
Let's do the Kimmel thing.
By the way, I saw them protesting outside our gym because it's across from ABC.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck is all those? And it was that.
Oh.
The Chinamen?
Yep. That's what it
Chinese
was.
Chinese people are mad?
Wow.
Yeah.
Chinese?
Outside the
You know, the
ABC.
Dalai Lama was staying at the Beacon Hotel the other day. I waited outside with all the, you know, the Chinese.
Yeah.
I waited outside there for about an hour with my young son waiting for the Dalai Lama to exit. They were all waiting for him just to exit and get in a car.
Yeah, just so they could get a picture of him or something?
Maybe a little blessing or something.
Tibet.
Did you see him?
No.
Why?
I had to give up. You could only spend so much time waiting for the Dalai Lama.
Well, he did three days in the Beacon.
Lama.
Is that what that was?
3 days he was there, yeah.
Yeah. What does he do?
Probably does a talk or whatever, you know.
Does he do any covers?
Big hitter to Lama.
I should have got a laugh. Come on, Beacon Theater.
I know, that's true.
All right.
That's true.
But what does he do, really? He just talks?
Yeah. Yes, I don't know.
He prays?
He talks. He probably, he spreads his fucking whatever it is that he spreads.
Oh, and it made me think of something.
The Dalai Lama?
You know how we talk about the Dalai Lama in the elevator in Atlanta?
Uh-huh.
I need to know this from you right now.
Yeah.
That actually happened, right?
Yes, it did.
Because so much time has gone by, I'm like, did that actually happen?
No, we were in the elevator with the Dalai Lama.
We were, right?
Oh, you were.
Yeah.
But it was one of those things, my mind's starting to go, there's no way you were in an elevator with the Dalai Lama. So I go, because after waiting for the Dalai Lama, I go, I got to ask Ann if that actually happened, because now I'm not sure anymore.
Did that really happen?
Yeah. You know, because we pump up some of our shit a little bit to make it a little better for the radio, but we were in an elevator with the Dalai Lama in Atlanta, and we didn't give a fuck, remember?
It was exactly a week after we
got fired.
Took a blimp and threw bra bombs.
But it was one of those things, I'm like, we were, and we didn't care.
Did you say hi to him?
We were staying at the Ritz-Carlton in Atlanta. We were down there for an interview.
Yeah.
And he had the whole top floor, I guess. And somehow, me and Anthony, the Dalai Lama, and one of his security guys, that happened, right?
Flowing robes, grace, bald, striking.
The Dalai Lama stays in the Ritz.
Yeah, yeah.
Why didn't we take a picture or anything?
Well, I don't think we had a camera. It was back in those days.
Where you just didn't have one on.
Ah, you don't have a camera. Everyone needed a camera. You had to carry one around with you. Crazy.
Just in case something was going
to
go down.
And you only carried a camera around to special events.
Right.
The only people that actually carried a camera all the time were like, you know, freelance news photographers. So a lot of shit happened that you just missed. Now, you get to see what people are having for fucking lunch. Real productive. It's amazing how many miraculous things just turn into, like...
Well...
commonplace.
People were all in with their social networking, and I'm noticing people are dropping off.
Are they?
They're realizing they're...
Waiting for the next big thing?
No, they just don't have enough shit to put out there.
Oh.
Because they, you know, they did their the pictures of their lunches. You haven't noticed? Especially on Facebook.
Yeah.
People starting to drop out.
They're dropping out with the posting their lunch pictures.
They're just dropping out in general.
I was thinking of the miracle was the laser beam. Many, many years ago, getting a beam of light to laze was amazing. Now, you use it so your cat can fucking run around the house like a lunatic.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
It was a miraculous thing. It took a fucking room of equipment to get a laser light. Now you pick up a little fucking thing, and you use it to, you know, drive your cat nuts. It's just astounding where we've come as a
technology. It's amazing, right?
Technology.
Did you do a Seinfeld reference in there?
No, I swear. Nope.
Not that one before.
Oh, it was just a line, I guess.
Which one?
Which one was it? Oh, the hair. The hair.
Oh.
Is it lustrous?
Oh.
Can you run your fingers through it?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So Jimmy Kimmel, I didn't know they were protesting. Wow, so this is becoming a little bit of a thing, huh?
I don't even know what he did.
Watch Kimmel, though?
No, it was one of those things where it's a fake outrage thing. It was a funny bit, and, you know, it's just another, more special interest garbage. So the network, of course, buckles and takes the dick and apologizes. And then people wonder why the Redskins' name is going to be changed. It's fucking amazing.
Enough groveling, people.
Yeah, can somebody? I know there's money at stake, and it's easy for me to say because I don't run the network.
Stake.
And they're like, we don't just say you're sorry and protect the advertisers and make the money. Like, mm-hmm. I understand the business makes sense.
Yeah.
But all of the people who don't work for the network, if you're not going to push back against this politically correct fucking wall that's falling down on you, just don't fucking snivel when it breaks and crushes something that you like, because you're sitting there, you're bigger than the networks. All the people out there, the consumers, if you flooded the calls with networks with support for Jimmy Kimmel, and if you flooded them with support and said, we're not going to watch you if
it
you
doesn't
buckle.
Work that way.
No, of course not.
We have an apathetic nation.
Exactly.
It doesn't, it never works that way.
It never works that way.
People just turn the show on, enjoy it, but they're not willing to call and fucking we.
But they'll cry when it's gone.
Support him. Oh, yeah.
But where did
it go? Just it. How people are willing to not speak out against this political correct bullshit when everyone is threatened by it.
Yep.
You can slip up at work and lose your fucking job. That's hanging over your head. Forget about, are you doing your job? Are you doing it properly? Did you make a mistake at work? You know, say, hey, are you late to work every day? Fuck all that shit. That used to be how you used to lose your fucking job. Now, did you say something? Did you bring something in? Did you hang something in your cubicle that offended another coworker? You know, that now is the way you lose your fucking job.
Yeah.
It's
disgusting.
It's pathetic. And for people that that don't speak out against this and embrace it, you're an idiot because you're next. You know, you're down the line at some point.
But people are scared to speak out because then it might mean their job.
I know. That's why you need brave people like me.
Well, we got the FU money.
Oh.
We were always brave, though. We were or stupid.
Brave.
Probably stupid.
Courageous and stupid. Yes.
I think we're just stupid. Maybe we weren't brave. So Jimmy Kimmel has a terrific bit. It's a kids' table. They're talking about some issues of the day.
Stuff they do at that show, man.
Yeah,
this is very funny, creative bits.
Really funny.
Do we have the video, or we just go to this?
Yeah, I can get there.
Let's go to the video.
How about this? Get the video for the boss.
Damn. I already said yes.
I know, but you know he's too nice about it.
Damn.
And Mike Baker's coming in a few minutes. And Aziz.
What's he, a candlestick maker?
Yeah,
that doesn't make sense.
Fuck, it does so! Yeah,
right.
It doesn't.
Oh.
You know, all throughout this government shutdown, people kept saying...
Do you want me to play the whole thing or just the part that matters?
I don't know. How's the whole bit?
It's a funny bit, but...
Nice. Let's do it.
How long is it?
How long is it?
It's about 4 minutes.
Well, that's terrific. Fine. Let's go through it.
Righto.
I like it.
We just gained 3 minutes, if you're keeping track at home. We had a minute clip, now we're playing a 4 minute clip. I'm going to enjoy some oatmeal.
Hey, comment on it. You know.
Yeah, you know, we'll stop it a couple times.
I bet you will.
I'm saying Congress was acting like a bunch of kids, Some congressmen even said they finally brought the adults in the room to settle this today. So I thought it would be interesting to ask a group of actual children for their opinions on this subject. And so I did. Here now
Chinese
is the
subtitles
first installment of our hard-hitting news discussion panel.
It's a Chinese feed.
That's from a Chinese show.
It's not part of the bit.
Right.
Kids table. Welcome to Kids Table. I'm your host, Jimmy Kimmel. This is our table. These are our kids. Today's topic, politics. What are politics?
It's kind of, the politics are kind of like Barack Obama, the government.
And what is the president's name?
President Obama. Barack Obama.
Barack Obama.
Barack Obama.
How do you spell Barack?
M-R-A-C.
Dave Herman's jacking off like a fucking
pig. Barack-a-bum.
No.
All right, maybe we don't have to play the whole clip.
Wow.
Okay, let's move on from that.
Can you pause real quick?
What is the government shutdown?
This is what the mentality of people. It's in Chinese letters underneath being subtitled for those who can't understand the language. So they want you to be offended at something that somebody said on a show you don't watch in a language you don't understand.
There you go. Right.
That's for people who could understand it. And yet, meanwhile, they hear people laughing. How about this, all you fucking Chinese people or whatever kind of people are offended at this? How about you be offended at the way the Chinese government treats its citizens?
There you go.
How about instead of standing outside of fucking ABC protesting a dumb joke with your fucking stupid sensitivity, how about you stand outside the Chinese embassy and protest the way China treats some of its citizens?
How about you protest our own government for doing business with such a despicable nation as China? Yes.
Absolutely. This guy tells a dumb, and it's a funny joke, and it's funny because the kid said it, and it's obviously not a real thing.
Well, I'm still waiting for him to say something.
Yeah.
Funny.
Yeah, actually. Just kids fucking babbling. God.
Yeah, they always do.
Basically, it is the government shut down the parks, in which we need them to open it up, because parks should be allowed.
Brayden, you? What do you think?
The government shutdown is when the president, they shut down parks and people who work for the government.
That's exactly right, Brayden. Why do you think this is happening?
I don't know.
Braxton, you?
The government should step it up and stop being a little crybabies and make up their mind.
What do you think of that, guys?
Yeah, awesome.
Yes. Okay, next question. America owes China a lot of money, $1.3 trillion. How should we pay them back?
Shoot Kane and go all the way over and kill everyone in China.
Kill everyone in China? Okay, that's an interesting idea. Yes.
Put a huge wall so they can't come to us.
You're saying build a wall in China? It's a huge, great kind of a wall?
Yeah.
That would never happen.
A huge one.
So Allie, when you owe someone money, should you pay them back?
Never.
Well, then they won't lend you money anymore.
And that's the problem.
Should this country be forced to pay our own debts?
Yes!
Yeah, but you just said kill everyone in China a little while. What happened to that? Should we allow the Chinese to live?
Yes! But if we don't allow them to live, then they'll try to kill us.
But then they will all be killed.
Well, this has been an interesting addition. Do you see the context of that?
Fuck all those protesters and fuck their outrage. Oh, it makes me sick.
That's what they're.
Yeah.
I couldn't even tell.
That's our country.
What the outrage is.
Yeah.
It's dumb kids' ideas of what should happen.
And so, the joke is in the ludicrousness of a child's thought process.
Right.
And of the silliness of what a child thinks the answer is.
Maybe they're protesting because the kids aren't working.
Yeah. they're protesting the girl. Why wasn't she killed at birth? That's what you ought to be fucking crying about.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. Did Jimmy Kimmel write that line?
Oh, I don't know. But even if he did.
It's a little suspicious.
Maybe.
That the kids might have had a few lines they were fed.
Sure, maybe.
How do they have all their fingers at that age? They should have been ripped off in some machine.
Wow, okay.
I don't even see any problem with that.
Nope.
Dumb kids singing dumb shit. Whatever.
It's always been a bit, right?
And the Chinese are mad at what?
Kimmel.
In addition to the apology, ABC said it would remove the segment from all future broadcasts of the episode and will scrub it from any existing copies currently available online. It's a, they just panicked.
Take that Chinese dick right in your ass.
Exactly.
And apologize because it's a big special interest group. Nonsense. Utter nonsense.
We would never purposefully broadcast anything to upset the Chinese community, Asian community, anyone of Chinese descent, or community at large. What a groveling bunch of dickwads.
What a groveling country. It's the whole country.
It really
We're
is.
A groveling
Every fucking
nation.
Day it's one of
Every
them.
Day.
Every day.
Remember, it used to be
anything.
One every once in a while, and we would jump on it. It's pretty much every day now. Every fucking day.
Jack Cafferty, I love the fact he would not apologize for what he said. But again, because he's on a news channel, that was okay.
Yeah, but most of his colleagues would apologize.
Yeah, probably.
Jack Cafferty is his own man. He always has been.
Yeah.
He's a bit ornery.
Dexter Manley, too.
And fucking Dexter Manley.
He doesn't give a shit.
No.
Troikman
is queer. That's what he said.
He happens to think that Troikman's a queer.
Troikman.
And is unapologetic about it.
I hope that they'll recover on Sunday when they play against the Chargers. Maybe it was an AFC team or something. I'm hoping that they can redeem themselves come Sunday.
Was it a big jinx that Troy Aikman was doing the game, the former Cowboy?
I think Troikman's a queer.
Hello.
Oh, 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 oh,
I love Dexter Manley.
I think Troikman's a queer.
I guess it was a dead end with his phone numbers from earlier.
Yeah, they're trying.
Okay. We should take a break.
Damn.
Mike Baker's on his way in, but we might have to squeeze some Jacktober in while Mike Baker talks about his new show.
Would like a little Jacktober.
Okay.
It's been a while.
Why don't we try to do that? So we'll break here. We'll do some Jacktober. We'll do Mike Baker. We got Aziz coming in. At 9 o'clock. All right?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
The Opie and Aziz Show continues in moments.
And now these messages.
All right. All right, all right, all right. Got Mike Baker outside the studio.
Yes, yes.
I saw his new show, America Declassified, and I liked it.
Yes.
I absolutely liked it. They take like three stories, right? Yeah, yes. There's three every episode?
There's three, well, two or three.
Because I watched yours, I watched the second one, and I tapped out for the third.
Yeah.
It's not because it sucked. I was just done with it because I was watching the show for you, and I liked it there, Mike Baker.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You went down to Dallas to talk about the JFK thing.
We did.
Can I ask you before you went down to Dallas, what did you think about the JFK assassination? Ooh. Did you think it was a conspiracy before you did your own research?
He knows.
Yeah, yeah. I mean,
he's working inside.
The file, the outfit,
the other angles.
I mean, honestly,
a new medium called video. Yeah.
Of course,
you know, all.
When you go into training, that's actually the thing that people don't know. The first week, they tell you all these things,
right?
And
just to keep you in line,
right? And so
I think that's like an old Bill Hicks bit or something.
Yeah.
Where they show you the basement of the White House,
the new president. Yeah,
they bring him down. I didn't have a real point of view one way or the other beforehand. I mean, I felt as if with the conspiracy, I understood why people wanted to think that there was something there, and or believed, still believe that there's something there. And the show itself, America Declassified, on Sundays on Travel Channel at 10 p.m.
Nice.
See how I do that now?
Yes.
Yeah. I think a week's worth of training for that. And but I understand why there's this desire to have something bigger than just one lone, psychotic out there with a rifle.
Yeah.
And so what we try to do with the show, during the episodes when we're talking about a mystery or a conspiracy, is to try to peel back the layers and then let the viewers make a decision. We're not trying to just say, this is it, this is the answer, because it would be asinine, right?
Yeah,
you got 20 minutes for a story, perhaps, and we're not gonna solve everything. But we take aspects of the mystery, aspects of the conspiracy. We take the viewers behind the scenes at restricted or top-secret facilities mm-hmm. where we get access.
Jesse Ventura did that.
Yeah, did he?
Oh, boy.
Oh, yeah, boy, did he.
It was a little different, though, you know.
There's a name I haven't heard in ages.
I don't Jesse see, Ventura. You know.
In ages, he's popping up again.
I don't see Mike Baker out there at fucking, you know, Roswell.
Right.
Talking about UFOs.
Oh, jeez. No, I can guarantee the viewers
yeah.
that there will be no alien stories.
No alien.
There's no alien yeah. stories. As much as the viewers may want them.
Yeah, yeah.
We're staying
yeah.
away from them.
Jesse Ventura. Yeah. I think the whole conspiracy thing, I think people love conspiracies because they feel powerless without them. If you think of the Kennedy assassination, 9/11, things like that, if it, you just take it at face value, we're very vulnerable.
Right.
Is a president that vulnerable where a lone gunman can screw up the course of the country?
Well, back then, sure.
Yeah, right.
Not anymore, because now we look at our president, and he's very, very protected. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, there's layers you just don't even see. Yeah, I mean,
but if history has taught us one thing.
Right.
So let's get into the JFK thing.
Sure.
Talk about that episode and what you did.
Well, it was fantastic. We went down, we got the permission from the authorities. We didn't just spring on them and surprise it. And...
You didn't get a lot of permission.
We didn't get a huge amount of
permission. And I'll tell you why. Mike, I'll tell you why.
Why is that?
Because you couldn't stop the traffic.
Well, no, we did stop traffic. We didn't stop pedestrians.
There's
traffic.
One shot where I'm like, he's going to get hit by a car.
Oh, that was okay.
Okay.
Fair enough. All right.
So you didn't
enough.
Get a lot of clearance.
We didn't lock the city down.
Yeah, you couldn't get a couple cops to go, look, they're filming something for the Travel Channel. Mike Baker, ex-CIA, is on the X. They have the famous X down there where, you know, you could stand on, and that's where JFK got his head fucking blown off.
Yeah.
And you're doing a little quick look. I'm just proving that I saw the show.
Yeah.
And you're doing a little thing on the X, and I see the cars coming, and I'm like, this is the Travel Channel. They should have been able to stop the traffic for you.
And the funny thing was, I kept saying, okay, well, go back at that. Let's do it one more time, but try it from this perspective. And so we'd wait for the light to change. I'm thinking, well, yeah, okay, it's very high end. And you can see all the guys up at the traffic light thinking, I'm gonna hit this motherfucker.
and to them, it's just another traffic light. They live in that town. They don't give a fuck about the JFK assassination. They just want to get home. So when that light turns green, because me and Jimmy witnessed this, they start flying down that sort of, it's kind of a hill.
Right.
A little bit of a hill right there.
Everybody's worried they're going to get popped if they take, you know, and, so they speed through.
Well,
they don't want history to repeat itself.
Right? And we saw, I forgot if it was a lady.
A woman almost.
It was
hit.
A woman, right? Geez. We saw a woman almost get fucking crushed because people assume, well, that's where JFK got, you know, shot. It's an X. I'm a tourist. Of course I could just go out there and get a picture. Right. They don't even notice that cars
sort of
are coming.
Invincibility. If
it's
I talk
a working public road.
Yeah. But we saw a lady almost get fucking. Yeah. I mean, it was close,
well,
man.
It's three lanes of traffic. They're moving, like you said. By the time they hit that little slope, they're flying. So
anyway, down there.
So we went down there, and if anybody hasn't been down to Dealey Plaza or hasn't been to the Book Depository Museum, they should go because it's a fantastic experience. But so what we were looking at was kind of walking back through Lee Harvey Oswald's story, but at the same time looking at the conspiracy from a couple of different perspectives. And one witness in particular was quite compelling, a guy named Lee Bowers, who worked at the train station. He was a station master up in the switching tower that is actually behind the grassy knoll. And his testimony was about the second gunman, about seeing a muzzle flash, seeing something behind the picket fence that looks down over the grassy knoll onto the road. And so we ran some forensic testing on that to see just basic things to see whether Lee Bowers could have been credible. Could he have seen what he thought he saw or what he claimed he saw? Looking at his death, he died.
Before you move on to that, sorry. Yeah. You're downplaying it, but you got access to that tower.
We did.
You're one of the first media people to ever do that, right?
Right, right. And thank you for calling me a media person.
My
life is now complete. So we did. We got access to the switching tower.
How did you get
up
access?
There. You know what? We told them we were the federal authorities.
We're doing an investigation.
Travel Channel worked very hard, and the production company Indigo Films that worked with them on this, they worked very hard at all of these various stories. And It was really impressive what they were able to do and the places we were able to go. Hmm. And, I mean, we went down to the country's only underground burial vault for radioactive waste. We went down to White Sands Missile Range, out to Ground Zero in the Mercury Town. I mean, we went to places that were really fantastic. And they really worked their ass off to get access for this. Because, again, mm-hmm. the idea, let's take the viewers someplace where they couldn't normally go on their own. Or someplace that's got a mystery or a conspiracy around it.
Give them some information and
let
them mix that in what they know already and see what they come up with. Right.
Informative, entertaining. Yeah, mm-hmm. There you go.
But, so you're in the switching tower.
We're in the switching tower. We ran some tests. We had a shooter at the picket fence firing off several rounds. The first time that's happened in 50 years since the assassination. And we did stop traffic for the tests there. And if you want to get an interesting result, go down to Dealey Plaza, because we couldn't stop the pedestrians from wandering about, and fire a rifle.
Oh, shit.
In Dealey Plaza. It was highly interesting.
Did people kind of jump a little bit, get a little jumpy?
Yeah, there was a busload of Japanese tourists, and they were loving it afterwards. They couldn't believe what they were seeing. But we fired off several rounds from there, and then I had a chance to do the same. In terms of determining the nature of the shot,
mm-hmm.
and you know how difficult would it have been for a second shooter from behind that position to get this thing done. And then what are they going to do? How do they get off the X? And then we went up and we looked. They gave us terrific access up in the book depository in terms of getting to the actual vantage point for Lee Harvey Oswald.
That's glassed off. They let you behind the glass?
Well, they didn't put us behind the glass. They let us to a no-access area right above it. Okay. So we were one floor above the sixth floor, but we were at the window. And they allowed us to go up there, it was very interesting. They wouldn't allow us to take a shot from there. I think they felt that might have been too insensitive.
A little much?
Yeah, stretching a little bit too far. But it was.
What was your opinion, looking out that window, feasible?
Yeah, it's 175 feet. Right? Uh-huh. It's 175 feet.
Which isn't that far of a shot, really.
It's not that far. The digital analysis or forensics work on the Zapruder film has, you know, it looks at about 8.2 seconds or so for getting three shots off with a bolt-action rifle. Mm-hmm. People say, well, it was Lee Harvey Oswald. He was a mook. He had no training. Well, he was in the military, mm-hmm. and he did get his marksman badge, his credentials.
He was a sharpshooter first, I think. He tested marksman before he left the military, but he did test sharpshooter earlier than that.
Yeah, and then if you don't keep practicing, which you know a lot of guys don't, then they test and they get a lower certification. But you know,
it's not like he got the headshot first round off either.
No, if you've got training, if you've got some level of training, you've got no wind or weather conditions. You've got a target that's moving maybe 5 miles an hour,
mm-hmm.
dead on line with you. You've already recce'd. He worked at the book depository, and so he had a chance. He knew exactly where he wanted to be. He knew exactly what that shot was going to look like. And so in terms of just from an operational point of perspective, could he have done it? Well, yes. I don't think there's any doubt he could have done it.
But what I don't understand, why take the shot after the turn?
Because to take it the other way, the Secret Service would be looking up at you.
They're thinking?
If you took it head on,
hanging out the window, right?
Yeah, you took it head on. Every agent is looking in your direction. Every cop's looking in your direction.
Think as he makes that turn, so the focus is all heading down now.
Sure. Uh-huh.
And so and then as he makes that turn, and now he's also right
focused somewhere else. I understand.
So he had a very good line of sight. Now, does that mean that it knocks out the conspiracy theory and all those other angles? And was he acting? And this is a very interesting point. Was he acting on his own? Or, you know, I think he was the trigger guy.
Mm-hmm.
I think he was the shooter. But were there other factors at play?
Right, right.
You know, so we look at Lee Bowers. We look at how he died as a witness in a very mysterious fashion. And, you know, Belzer's on there. Richard Belzer's on there talking about the conspiracy theory. He's very interesting.
The bells,
So it's good, but he died in a car crash on a two-lane country road by himself when he went off the road and you know crashed.
That
into
sounds
a small
like
bridge.
It's written for a movie,
but
right
is that
there.
That odd
right.
though? When you like, I've heard about all these dead. I thought I remembered it was a car crash. It's like it's a single car crash. They happen all the time.
Mm-hmm.
If, you know, because he was tied to the Kennedy assassination, it sounds ominous.
Mm-hmm.
But single car crashes happen all the time.
Except and then his body was cremated that evening.
All the more reason to do it that way, so people could go. It happens all the time.
Yeah. This was a great point you guys made. They didn't cremate like they do today.
No,
it was a lot rarer to cremate a body back in '63.
Yeah, and he was cremated that night. According to the reports.
Wow.
Which is a little unusual. His family was, who knows what that was all about. But the problem is that, you know, so many of these folks have passed away. And, you know,
It's been 50 years.
It's been 50 years, exactly. A lot of the people, exactly. So I think that's mysterious.
Right.
50 years and they're still not as young as they used to
be. But, Mike, let me ask you, of all this stuff, what is it that made you think? Because, believe me, it's hard to swallow the single gunman theory. But that's what I've come to believe again, because I just, no other theory, no conspiracy theory held water. None of them. Mm-hmm. Like the guy was in the, and they shut up all the witnesses. It's just, it's so illogical. Well, they would use this asshole Oswald, who was an asshole, who'd already fired at another public official. This is the last dumb motherfucker you'd use for this.
It's very dysfunctional. You know, he had a failed experience trying to start a new life in Russia. And, you know, I mean, so you're absolutely right. And that's what I always kind of lean towards with some of these stories. Like we did an episode on Martin Luther King, and we were down in Memphis. Again, sort of great access. Was up on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel, outside his door with Reverend Kyles, who was with him when he was shot. He and Ralph Abernathy were in there, and they all started to come out. And Dr. King stopped, leaned over the railing to talk to Jesse Jackson and Andrew Young and a couple others down there, and then he got popped. And so we did, again, same thing. We were running some forensic tests. We talked to a lot of people. Very interesting. And the same idea. People didn't want to think that it was just James Earl Ray, you know, shooting out of a second-story bathroom window in a rooming house across the street. They wanted to think it was something different. But when you look at that, at the conspiracy, to Jim's point, you think, really? So you know, because the conspiracy theorists in that story, you know, they're thinking it's Hoover. It was the Memphis PD. It was the mob, and it was military. Mm-hmm. All of them working together. And at the end of it all, they decide on James Earl Ray, you know, as the guy who's going to be the fall guy.
Yeah.
And then they let him go, and he escapes to London for 2 months and gets picked up. So a lot of the conspiracy theories are you can set aside. But some of them do linger. Some of them are you get the feeling they're always going to be unsettled.
What's the lingering one in JFK, or a lingering aspect of it?
Well, people, the same thing. People don't want to believe that it was Lee Harvey Oswald. And I think what you said was actually right. I think that they was actually right. I think you said something that was actually right.
Thanks, Mike.
Golly
gee.
Gosh. Yeah, I know. How stupid was that statement? But I think when they look at JFK, you think about the time frame. And we weren't used to seeing stories every other day about some nut job, you know, with a rifle going into a school or wherever and shooting it up. And it just, you know, news traveled slower. People's expectations were different. And certainly at that time, the idea that it was just one man who impacted the nation so much was very hard to believe.
Yeah.
And it fueled this idea that there was something else. And the longer it stays out there, I think, the longer it lingers. You know, it's harder to get rid of.
Right.
What is a part of it that you think made you think it might be a conspiracy?
Well, there was another witness you had in the stairwell.
Yeah, there was a witness
never came forward before.
Was never interviewed. There were a lot of people that weren't interviewed, which is interesting, but not completely atypical in investigations. I mean, things get missed. Mm-hmm. You know, interviews don't happen. But she was there in a position where if Lee Harvey had come running down that stairwell, given her position, and she was credible in terms of checking her out, she would have seen something. She would have seen him. But what instead was, you know, no, I didn't see anybody coming down the stairwell. And she was clear as a bell. She was a sharp individual. I'm not saying, again, I don't say that refutes the fact that he was the gunman. What's the most compelling part of the JFK conspiracy? I mean, for me, I spent so much time behind a curtain, really, at the outfit, that I'm not a conspiracy guy by nature. And so, you know, I went into it, you know, with an open mind, but I didn't, I'm not a skeptical person by nature. I tend to think that sometimes things are just as simple as they seem.
Right.
You know?
But sorry to interrupt you. What you say about, like, the one who didn't see him come down the steps. I saw an interview recently with a kid, a young black guy. He was probably 16 when it happened, and they re-interviewed him now in his adult life, many, many years later, who saw Oswald poke out the window, or somebody with a rifle poke out that window. And there was a photographer, and I want to say he's the one that won the Pulitzer for snapping the Jack Ruby, that death photo of Oswald. And his great regret was that he didn't snap the photo when he saw the guy with the gun and he's the day before saw somebody with a rifle leaning out that window
the
or
day
in that
before,
window.
Yeah.
The assassination. I'm sorry. Right. At the and he said he one of his great regrets was not snapping that fucking.
Why
would
he?
I think
you got Secret Service.
I think you got one good picture there, fella.
But that was like his redemption.
Don't worry about it.
Because they didn't think in the moment. You know, you saw all these cops and stuff around. It was
a
different.
If you're a photographer, don't you just kind of shoot everything around you?
Oh, maybe. Yeah. But maybe he missed the shot. Maybe he saw it and missed it.
Yeah. Well, that could be. That could also be. You know, Secret Service, because Secret Service are wrecking the, you know, sites like that all the time, and so it could well have been somebody.
Something you don't see every day, whether it's Secret Service or, you know, Oswald, you're going to take the picture, I think.
Yeah, maybe he tried to and missed it.
Yeah.
But every episode we're doing something that I think, I hope, the viewers are going to find, you know, really interesting. And we're trying to approach it from the point of view that they want something more out there. They want some information. Obviously, everybody wants to be entertained.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
You know, not every show can be, you know, two dames fighting over a wedding dress. You know, so.
People are fascinated by that whole thing, though, you know, conspiracies and what happened. Well, they want more information. What else are you working on for them?
We did a variety of things. We did the Escape from Alcatraz, the 62.
Nice. Oh, right. Yeah, that's fun.
What do you think happened with that? I've been to Alcatraz.
Yeah, fascinating place. And it's fantastic.
I love Alcatraz.
They gave us access. Unbelievable.
You get to see that the average tourist doesn't.
Right. And we were there at nighttime. Because
some of those tunnels that they have the ropes across, I'm like, man, I wish I knew someone here so they could take me on a tour.
We didn't start working. We didn't really start filming each day until after everybody had left. The tourists had left, and so we were there basically through the night.
Wow.
And that's an interesting experience walking around. And they literally just let us, you know. So I wandered all over that place. And at nighttime, it's a pretty fucked up place.
It's got to be pretty creepy, right?
Yeah, but
it's
they,
pretty cool.
We went in.
Have you ever been in?
No, never been there.
That's awesome.
Again, same thing. People should be going to these places. And I say that over and over during these shows. I said, if you haven't been here, you got to come take a look at this.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's so many places around this country to see. But Alcatraz, we looked at Frank Morris and the Anglin brothers.
How about Charlie Butts?
Charlie Butts.
Now we got to go back and do a whole new story.
Yeah.
So Frank Morris and the Anglin brothers, they went on about a year-long effort to get themselves out of Alcatraz, and it was an incredible effort. And they basically discovered that the walls were crumbling because of age and the conditions, the weather conditions, and the type of concrete. And so every night they would kind of use a spoon or whatever they had. Frank Morris made like a little makeshift electric drill out of a motor he took out of a vacuum, and they would drill and drill and drill and drill through this concrete until they'd made spaces. And when you look at these spaces and think what they did, they crawled behind it. And what they'd found was from other inmates who were being, you know, put to work by the guards to do plumbing, they found that there was a 3-foot crawl space behind their cells, in between the cell blocks. And so if they could get through the back wall of their cell, these cells are tiny, they'd get into this crawl space. And then they found, over the course of a year, they crawl up these pipes, they get to the top of the cell block, and they figured out a way to get onto the roof to get through. They had to cut through rebar, and they tried a variety of things to get through the rebar in this concrete. And what they finally settled on was they would take dental floss from the dental shop, and then they would take contact cement from the shoe shop. They all had to work. It's amazing. Not like today. These guys all had to work.
Right,
and
yeah.
They had to take contact, and they would cover the dental floss in contact cement, and then they cover it with silica that they got from the dental shop, and they would let it harden, and then they would use it like a little band saw.
Type of,
And they would just day after day, night after night.
How long did that take? Holy shit.
It took about a year. And they could only work at night after the lights off. And most of the prisoners
were really tired.
Well, right. most of the prisoners were in on
because
it.
Because you had to make noise. And so every time they would prisoners would start making noise or banging pots or whatever. And some of the things that these guys did were really impressive in terms of just trying to get yourself out of there. Now, they had some time on their hands, right?
So, true. Where are they going?
Yeah. And then they did, but they didn't know really much at all about the tides, the ebb, the current in the bay. But then they made a raft out of raincoats issued from the prison, and using contact cement. And then they made some homemade paddles out of some wood that they stole from pallets. And one night they took off in November 62, and that was the last anybody heard from them. So we did the same thing. We recreated the raft out of that same crappy material, made some wooden paddles, and tried to.
Did the rats hold up in the water?
No. No, it was like, you know what it was like? It was like trying to paddle a hot tub. It filled up with water. And so, and we're out there in the middle of the bay for hours, right? And just not going anywhere. And, well, we are going somewhere. We're going out to sea.
Oh, and, man. The currents are that rough?
Currents are awful. And if you don't get it right, you're screwed. And so, you know, there were a lot of odds stacked against these guys. But, you know, just the sheer will of trying to do this and get the hell out. And then, but then you got to think, once they finally got out and over the wall and down the rock and down to the water, and then, you know, these three guys, you know, they were just, you know, they weren't pleasant guys. But now they're looking at the bay thinking, so they had to get in the water in the middle of the night in November.
Oof.
And try this. It's a fascinating thing. We ended up swimming because the paddling just wasn't going to work.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
anyway.
So how far was it from, I know they thought they went to Angel Island.
Right.
How far was the, from Alcatraz to the mainland, was a mile? Or not quite a mile.
It's not that far.
It's not that far. It's about a mile. But it's their concern was apparently, according to talk to some of what they gathered information from the prisoners, was their concern over being discovered as soon as they, you know, set foot on ground.
Uh-huh.
And so because it was, and you could sit in Alcatraz in those days and in the cells, and you could hear the noise of people in the bars and having fun and you know,
the rock club.
Right. And so,
you know, that's torturous. Yeah.
Exactly.
That drove them nuts, they said, was hearing the women having a good time at the yacht club.
Right. Unbelievable. Yeah. But Whitey Bulger and was there at the time, and he's been in the news recently, Al Capone, of course, and but we had a chance to talk. We talked to a guy named Patrick Mahoney.
Oh, Whitey Bulger was in there?
Whitey Bulger was there when they broke out. But Patrick Mahoney was a guard that night. And a fantastic guy, huge guy, hands like, you know, hams.
Exactly.
So that's the second season. That's Patrick Mahoney declassified.
Big cocks across America.
So,
shit.
Well, you gotta keep moving forward. Don't you?
Of course,
you
know? Yeah, yeah.
But Patrick Mahoney was there, and he talks about it, and he talks about. And he's just a big guy, and you can see it still burns in him. You know, the idea that these guys got away, whether they lived or not, it just pisses
them
out.
They got out. Yeah, whatever. They did get out.
Did they ever find anything in the movie? They find a little bit of the, you know, flour, which is nonsense. But what did they ever find any trace of the raft or anything?
They didn't. No, not the raft. They found personal effects, and they found a paddle. They found because these guys had. You know, they had taken different time, right? And think about prisoners now escaping. But these guys had actually fashioned out of that same raincoat material. They fashioned a couple of little envelopes or something. And they put some letters in there and things that they wanted to hold on to.
You know, what like the fuck?
Letters from mom, you know.
Yeah.
And so they, you know, they found some of that floating in the bay. Because they went out. And then the morning call, when they went to rouse the prisoners up, you know, they'd go along the line and, you know, one of the I think it was Frank Morris didn't get up. That was the first one they noticed, and so one of the guards walked up to the bars, you know, and said to the bars, and you know, which I guess is what they would say, because I just said it, and so he didn't move, and so he kind of, you know, went in there and jabbed him, and that's when his paper mache head fell on the floor.
Yeah, they
and
actually
Patrick Mahoney said that guard screamed like a girl.
Oh, really? That would scare the shit out of you.
Yeah, exactly.
What was the common belief by the warden and the guards? I mean, do they really think that they got? We all like to believe it. They probably drowned, and I hate to say that. Because no one ever heard of any of them. You didn't tell me two brothers and Frank Morris just went through the next 50 years
disappeared. Right.
Without being heard from. Yeah, I mean, or getting rearrested for anything or pulled over driving or, you know.
Yeah. No, most of the guards think they died. And a lot of people think they died.
Yeah.
And I, you know, I think the odds are hugely stacked against them. And I agree with it. The fact that nobody talked, you're going to tell me, look, people can't keep their yap shut over a period of time. And that's, you know, to your point again with JFK, you know, you think that somebody's not going to talk in a vast conspiracy.
And what did they do for a living? They didn't commit any more crimes. They didn't, you know, in all those years, you would assume something.
Unless they went to Canada. And back then, it was easier to lose yourself and change your identity because you weren't tracked electronically. So that's possible. They could have went to Canada, given different names, and lived. Or maybe one of them found a way to get on a plane and went to London. You know, who knows? But I doubt it.
Right. It would be very difficult. But it was a fascinating thing. And I tell you what, that water's cold.
61 or 62?
62. Okay. The end of 62. And that water's very cold.
Huh?
It's teeming with wildlife. Didn't see any sharks, but there's a lot of activity in the bay, and it's fantastic. One of the biggest threats was they were working on the World Cup, what do they call it, America's Cup. All right. And so, you know, the boats were out there practicing. It was before it started. And, you know, these things are moving like rocket ships. They don't look like sailing boats anymore.
No, right? Of course not.
Yeah, and spaceships with a sail.
Right,
yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And barely a sail. It's a little fin. And so this thing was, Emirates boat was out there rocketing around at 35 or 40. And you know, we're out there in this
with some stupid, shitty fucking raincoat.
We're heading out to sea, boys. And I had two great guys with me. Both are professional swimmers who you know, have swum the bay a lot. Uh-huh. And you know they signed on because they thought, yeah, anybody's stupid enough to try this, let's give it a go. But they were, you can see even halfway through, they were completely frustrated with these paddles, and they just wanted to get in the water and swim
and
you know?
Swim for it.
And I said, no, I think we got to keep paddling. Anyway.
I have heard the theory that they were helped by someone in a boat. Who met them in the thing? Whether the guy English, played by Paul Benjamin in the movie, I forget what his, I don't know what his real name was, but that the black guy that he might have had somebody meet them, and that if that happened, that's the only shot I think they had, is somebody actually met them, you know, on some prearranged night or maybe one of many nights they were out there waiting for them.
Yeah, all bets are off if they actually were smart enough and capable enough to get that done. But we talked to the U.S. Marshal. Who is still on the case. It's an active case. It's an open case.
That's amazing.
Yeah, exactly. So it's a great story, but there's a lot of these just like that in this show, America Declassified, on Travel Channel on Sundays at 10 p.m.
It's an open case.
Great, but, man.
It's an open case, but what is he doing 50 years later? Like, what lead is he tracking down?
You see him on the coast just kicking with his foot looking for something.
He does this a lot.
puts his hand over his forehead and looks
squints
into the sun.
Walks up and down Fisherman's Wharf with pictures of the guy. Say, have you seen him?
Seen this guy?
Yeah. Imagine him a little bit older now. Have you seen him?
He just interviewed a new witness, and he realized it was one of the actors from Escape from Alcatraz. Yes, I interviewed Officer Zimmerman, who was there when the man chopped his fingers off. Doc.
Alcatraz is an amazing place.
It's fantastic.
And then just the ferry ride out to it is cool, you know?
Yeah, it is. The whole part. And you know what? There was a community out there. The guards. No. Lived out there with their families.
Oh, with their families.
And they went to school and
they
everything.
Went to school. Patrick Mahoney's, his kids were born out there. Their birth certificates say Alcatraz. Say, you know, amazing. Federal penitentiary.
And look how close it is. You don't realize how close it really was.
That's
to San Francisco.
That's a long swim in a November cold, though.
Yeah, it is, but if you're swimming for your life, you can probably motivate. Because Frank Morris was, at least the way they painted him in the film, an extraordinarily bright guy. And for guys to be this smart for a year, and then just be so dumb they don't realize the water's going to be cold, doesn't make a whole lot of sense either.
Right. Well, I mean, and you're right about that sort of that will to live. And if you got nothing else going for you,
just swimming for your life.
But at a certain point, the odds just.
It's an amazing plan and execution of the plan right up until you got to get in that fucking water.
Right.
Then it becomes a crapshoot, you know. Right. The rest of it, they did an amazing job of distracting the guards and thinking they were in there with the fake heads and figuring out how to get through that wall, up the pipes, get through the bars, like all that shit.
Right.
And then it's like, great, we got a current that'll pull you right out to sea, freezing cold water. I mean, obviously, they're not swimmers. Criminals.
Yeah, they've been eating prison food and smoking and they're not in great shape. But again, you can't underestimate sort of that will, that desire.
Yeah.
That when you know you got nothing else going, you know. And but again, it's just sort of like that. Okay, that takes you so far, but then the reality will kick in.
Yeah.
But we did. There's a lot of these things. We did the D.B. Cooper. You know, America's hijacking.
Nice.
Fantastic.
That's an amazing story too. Yeah.
What do you think about that? I obviously he's probably dead. But I mean, they found his money under silt or whatever, half of it, or the $5,000.
Yeah.
What do you think?
You know what? That's one where I fall back on the same thing we talked about before. To think that this guy would go out the back of a commercial jet in a business suit, in loafers. He landed without his shoes. There's no way you're going out there doing that jump.
They're going to keep your
shoes on. So he landed in the middle of the Snoqualmie Forest, which is a vast wilderness up in northwest America in Washington State. And the idea that he's going to survive the jump, first of all, and then get himself out of that forest, and it's very hard to believe.
But he could be living with Bigfoot.
Well, it could be, exactly. And people say, well, you know, we never saw him. We never spotted him. But when you stomp around, and we did for a long time, when you stomp around in that forest, you realize what it's like for search and rescue. You realize you almost have to step on the individual. And he was jumping out with a military-grade chute, you know, OD Green, And so that thing up there, hung up in the trees for all these years, people aren't just, you're just not going to spot
right.
it.
Right.
Didn't he, by the way, take the least of, like, he took, they said if he really knew what he was doing, he would have taken the other shoot. There was a couple of shoot options they gave him, and he right. didn't take the one that he right. probably was better for him to
right.
take.
Which was fascinating, because it's almost like they were just, I mean, who does this? But they gave him $200,000, and they gave him, you know, shoot options. He turned it back and said, no, I want. But his choice could be interpreted a couple of different ways. It could be interpreted that he did have some knowledge. I don't think he had any experience, but he had some knowledge of what was going on. But still, same thing. Going out the back of that plane, landing, and then trying to make your way out. If you get hung up in one of those fir trees, which I ended up having to do, and then trying to make your way out of your chute, out of your harness, and figuring out how to, you know, what are you going to do? How
to get down? Right?
And then get the hell out. And it's a tough old place. And the news came out quick. So the next day, the place, you know, it's vast, but there were a lot of people all out there hunting for $200,000, right?
Yeah.
All the townspeople came from the surrounding, you know, towns, and they were out there stomping around, and nobody ever found. And there are people who have been following this case for ever since, you know, for years,
yeah,
and years,
yeah.
and years. And I just think it's hard to imagine. They did find some money about 8-9 miles down the watershed, but. It's a tough one, but I tell you what, we recreated the jump. A good buddy of mine up in Washington State runs a great jump center, Kapowsin Jump Center, and they did a great job. So it's, you know, there's all these things going on. I think if the viewers give it a chance, I think they'll really enjoy it, and we're really doing everything we can to sort of drive eyeballs to the screen.
Yeah, yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah,
I learned that. It sounds
like a blast.
It's called America Declassified, airing on Sundays on the Travel Channel.
10 p.m. Yeah, and every viewer gets a free kitchen appliance. Personally delivered by Jim and I.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Look at that. But yeah, it's a new plan.
I'll do the funny spatula scene from Stripes on your hiney. Remember when I did the spatula with PJ Souls. I'll do that on your hiney. That stunk that scene.
All right, we should take a break.
Yeah, we'll take a break.
You can hang out, Mike. Certainly.
Amazing.
Thank you very much.
We might be doing some Jocktober next or something, but...
Yeah, if you hang out for this next segment, we will officially alienate you from every other radio show.
Exactly,
that's true.
So well, thank you very much, because it's something new. You know, I love coming in here and talking about whatever the hell's going on in the world.
But now you're a TV star.
This is different. Plugging something is a different feeling.
Project going on. It sounds really entertaining and fun and very interesting.
You're gonna take out Duck Dynasty.
Oh, wouldn't that be great?
Or at least take him out. You're gonna be the one.
Yeah, it'll be me. Or at least Honey Boo Boo.
Yeah. I don't like this newfound success.
I know, right? Look at that. Yeah, we won't see Mike again.
Yeah, no, I'm going to stay just as much of a douchebag as I've always
been. Very good. And you fit in perfectly here. Mike, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
The Opie and Anthony Show on Sirius XM.
Very funny. All right. You want to do some Jocktober before?
Yes.
Yeah, we haven't done Jocktober in a few days, I think.
I know.
The month is coming to a close.
Yes, it is.
It's Jocktober. A celebration of all things shitty in radio.
That's not very nice.
Fantastic failures of pontificating proportions.
That's so bad.
Wow.
An interactive exploration of what makes radio rancid. Jocktober. Hosts, holes, bits, and stunt boys.
This isn't funny.
It's time for Jocktober.
Want to see the boat movie?
All right. Going to Virginia, Richmond, Virginia.
Oh, what's in Richmond, Virginia?
Mornings with Melissa and Jack.
Oh, that sounds fun.
On 103.7 Play.
What do they play?
Why? 103.7 Play?
It's like push play, right? Like play?
Yeah.
I see a play button in their logo. So I guess, you know, we're going to be hearing the music.
Right.
It's the music.
Not just music.
Yeah.
A little personality thrown in there,
that's
too.
That's good. I see Kanye on their website.
John Mayer.
It's
the hits. They love playing the hits.
No twerking. You see that?
No.
They're one of those no twerking stations.
All the hits with no twerking.
That's just fun.
Yeah.
That's just some fun.
Well, what? Give me a little background on these two.
Well, Melissa and Jack. Melissa's the radio girl.
The fiery redhead.
She is a fiery redhead.
Fiery redhead.
Is she cute?
She's all right.
Well,
that picture, she looks all right.
That picture, she looks kind of cute.
All right, what's going on?
A little redhead.
What's going on?
You're right, that picture she does.
Mm-hmm. All right, show me another picture. That's Kim Kardashian.
That's another one.
That's Lily.
All right.
Where
is this guy? Show it to me, Sam, before your job is
I need a good mental image of these people, or else I can't hate them as much as I really want to.
That's her on the left?
Wait a minute.
A little thick, but not bad. She's cute.
It's a little different from the photo.
She's not bad.
That's nice.
Whatever.
He's a handsome guy. She's a pretty cute girl. All right.
Well, all right.
All right. So physically, they're not abominations.
Yeah.
And then you got Jack.
Well, yeah, Melissa.
What's their bio say?
Melissa's been doing radio for 10 years.
Whoa.
Over 10 years.
Oh.
Then she should know better.
She is the whole of the show, I would assume.
She grew up in Richmond.
Yeah.
And she lives with her husband, Tyler.
Born and raised.
Yeah.
I thought Jack was her husband.
No, Jack is a little younger.
Oh,
he's
boy.
Only been doing radio for a couple years.
Is he out of control? Does she need to rein him in?
Well, before he was in radio, they found him at a bar.
No.
Literally.
Oh, God. Is it like when Rocco had to
find his partner?
Get a partner.
At
so they
Fenway.
Picked a seat at Fenway and just happened to pick a guy that was has been in radio.
That's what a dumb bitch.
Bullshit.
Jack is one of Richmond's most beloved bartenders.
Uh huh.
Yeah, and he happens to love radio. So when he's not on air, you can usually find him working at the bar or drinking.
Hey, one side of the bar or the other, he's right at home.
Yeah, or driving fun. And ending someone's dream when he runs a red light.
Yeah.
Can we get right into this?
Let's hear these folks.
Well, they got a tease for an upcoming story, which ends in hilarity.
All right.
103.7 Play, mornings with Melissa and Jack.
It's 6:58. Today's going to be mostly cloudy with a high of 72.
Yawn. Stop with the weather. With the fucking weather.
The weather.
The weather is on fucking phone. Stop.
Let me see. Boink. There we go.
Yeah.
There's the weather. 55 degrees.
Yeah.
Partly sunny.
Yeah.
There you go.
And now the listeners
it's on my
it.
It's on my fucking phone.
You don't need to do weather on the radio.
No.
Unless it's a big superstorm or something.
I like information.
The 8 today is going to be mostly cloudy with a high of 72.
And a lot of us have done some strange things to look for love. There's a lot of unorthodox methods for it. But someone from Richmond has gone to the extreme. I mean, I kind of feel like she's giving more attention to this than you would, like, looking for a job. This is, like, a serious thing.
Yeah, she is, she wants to find a husband, and she is pulling out all of the stops. We're going to tell you about it. I mean, this woman is serious.
I kind of love her for doing this. It's so cute.
It's kind of psycho, too, but we'll talk about it.
That was the tease?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Kind of psycho.
Yeah.
We'll talk about it. I'm getting very annoyed with her voice.
Yeah,
very quickly.
About it, right?
It's that chick radio voice. You know how the guy has radio voice? Like, that is the epitome of the chick radio voice.
A lot of weird listeners to this show.
Oh, yeah?
I'm only judging that based on their Facebook page.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Their Facebook
page. We'd like to go to their Facebook
page
to get to know them a little more. Sure.
Fans posting?
Yeah, one's posting just photos of Coke floats. Just,
wow, that's weird. I
Coke
why they
floats
do that.
In my cup, E-Rock Army, and then they write the N-word with an A.
Oh, my God.
One person named Dolores Chipperson, which looks like Jim Norton with lipstick on, writes, any black guys with big peckas.
That's not funny at all. That's my mother.
Hey, it's Scorch.
Yeah, it's a picture of Scorch that says, I'm taking your jobs now. You know what I mean?
It's E-Rock and Roland on those scooters.
The fat twins.
It's the fat twins from the Guinness Book of World Records.
Wow, that's a first.
That is a good one.
You see what the caption says?
No.
Too fat, too furious.
Mm-hmm. I
Boat My Tree Dude.
I have no idea.
More E-Rock photoshops.
Mm-hmm. I thought that was E-Rock shitting on the side of the expressway, but it's not. We all know he did that. Well, DJ Douche.
It's a photo of E-Rock. Aww. Photo of me and Travis. There's a photo of what looks to be an old man, no shirt on, with a beard, having sex with another man.
He's obviously plowing another man in his ass.
Yeah.
Oh, a deformed baby.
Yep.
That's a good one. That's beautiful.
It's October.
Yeah, okay.
There's a photo of a pig enjoying some food from a trough. He's full of mud and dirt.
Yeah.
Except it's E-Rock's head.
E-Rock's head
the
on
the dreamy
it,
face.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
What the fuck?
An exploited large woman.
Fat woman.
Oh.
All right. Let's
God damn.
She's lovely. She's got very Rubenesque features. Salah's a total
vagina.
Faggot. Who wrote that?
You know the story that they just teased a moment ago? We're going to find out if Melissa gives any whole
thank God
cues.
Oh, okay.
She could be a whole.
So a lot of us put a lot of effort into going on dates. Obviously, you hear that in second date every morning. You know, it takes a lot to try to go on that first date and make sure that that relationship works. But when you find yourself not even getting a first date, sometimes you got to pull out all stops, and that's what someone here in Richmond is doing.
Let me go to a story about a serial rapist.
Local woman, Davise Clement, I think I pronounced that right. She's a former ad executive with Barton Agency. She's now a hairdresser. Has decided to launch a full-scale ad campaign to find a husband.
I love this.
We're talking billboards. We're talking print. We're talking TV. Possibly radio.
Even drink coasters that she's going to leave out at bars with her contact info in case the right person comes along.
I mean, this you think this is a good idea. I think it's the way to find a bunch of creepy dudes.
Stop. No way.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No way.
That's a typical hole right there.
Stop. No way.
That voice is so fucking annoying.
This show is not enraging, though. It's just like...
Not yet.
You know.
No way.
Not yet.
Yeah, it's not gracious.
There's a photo of Jim Chandler, and the brilliance... Here's the
my
brilliance of this
college
photo.
Pal. I started radio with this guy.
This is the person that Opie used to do college radio with that was featured on Jocktober last year.
Or 2 years ago now, maybe.
They they took his smile, and in Photoshop, they turned it upside down and made it a frown.
They made it a frown.
And then the caption says, Greg Hughes crushed Jim Chandler's dreams on purpose. And that's
frowning.
On 103.7 Plays
that's
Facebook
weird.
Page.
Yeah, that's
reason.
Weird. I don't know why.
Well, Melissa certainly is a hole with that.
Oh, no, no way.
There's a Photoshop of Laurel and Hardy, and then under that is Colin Quinn and Bobo.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
well,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
They're the new team.
But we do have to check something.
Uh-oh.
Because it appears that...
Oh, where's the...
What happened?
Phase one is complete. There is no public wall.
Why? Why would they do that? We didn't even give out the Facebook
But we
page.
Do know that in the comments on their pictures, right?
Oh, yeah. You can still comment
right.
on their pictures. For instance, they posted a funny YouTube video of Katy Perry and Robert Pattinson or whatever his name is.
Yeah.
And the first two comments, number one is, I want to see the boat movie.
Oh.
And number two is, it's a battery car.
It's like a battery car.
Yeah. It's a battery car.
It's like a battery car.
Hey, it's Mr. Cock-a-Doodle Fox. How you doing? You've been phone scammed. How you doing?
I can't feel my nose.
This is Lindstrom Perry Dorkins. Yeah. Hey, this is Waffadoodle McFunny Nook. Did you leave your bee stingers in my hat?
What?
This is Funny Boobs McElbow Knuckle. Did you leave your bowling balls in my shoes?
Do you have the nose clip too, E-Rock?
Did you can't even feel my own nose.
I can't even feel my own nose.
Do you know how funny that would be if he was saying that as they loaded him into the back of an ambulance?
Oh, shit.
Well, guys.
I don't wish him ill.
We're looking at Melissa and Jack, and it's time for the second date playback.
Yeah, I heard her allude to this.
Yes.
Second Date Playback on 103.7 Play.
Second Date is where we attempt to help you with your love life. Sometimes you go on what you thought was a great first date, only to have the person not call you, not text you afterwards, just completely ignore you. And that's where we come in. We actually put them on the radio, and we try to get them to tell you what went wrong
and why
they haven't called you back for a second date. No.
Good morning, Craig. How are you?
I'm good.
All right, Craig, so tell us what happened.
So this girl that comes into the bar where I bartend, she has been, I guess you would say, hounding me for like the last 2 months. Her friends have also been mentioning it. She's just been really interested, you know? And I can tell that she's been interested. She'll stay a little bit later than everybody.
So fuck her and shut up.
And then finally I was like, you know what? Fine, I'll take her out on a date, you know? We went out on a date and, you know, it wasn't stellar, the date, but it wasn't bad. It was just, it just sort of happened, you know? And now
I
called her and it's been 2 weeks and I haven't heard anything back from her.
Oh.
You know, just nothing.
So basically you got forced, not forced, but kind of
coerced
into taking her out, and now she's just avoiding you?
Yeah.
Is this real? Do you think it's real?
Of course not.
No.
But it's I do
almost get tricked every
time. You know
why?
The setup sounds like something.
I thought it was fake.
No. I don't mean their actual execution of the setup. I mean the setup itself. You got a guy. He goes out on a date. You call the girl or something. Like, it's something that could be done. But it's not like the roses one where it has to fall in place like a miracle.
Yeah, but you're confused.
Why? What happened?
They don't call and say you're on the radio.
Oh.
Here they say, "Oh, this is Jack's friend. I just wanted to know if you thought that."
Uh-huh.
Okay. Oh, you're on the radio.
All right.
So it's another service, I guess, huh? This will be sweeping the country soon.
By the way, if you go to their Facebook page where the wall was closed,
right?
Uh huh.
I guess some people realize that Melissa from Melissa and Jack has her own Facebook page.
Oh, that's nice.
How do they realize that? We haven't given out any of this info.
I guess there's a link to it, but there's just a lot of weirdness going on her page.
She looks good in that picture.
Yeah,
she kind of looks like the girl from Mythbusters.
She's using a squish.
Carrie Byron,
oh, yeah, she indeed.
She's using like a squishy app.
Yeah, there's something going on there. Some voodoo.
Squishing the sides in a little bit.
Technological magic.
Why is Jim Chandler on her personal page?
Right next to Trayvon.
Yeah.
That's her?
That looks a lot
different.
What
happened? Now she looks like Tony Soprano's sister.
Janice.
Oh my God. What happened? How do you go from Carrie Byron to Tony's sister, Janice?
Oh.
Wow.
She does look like she's dating a narcoleptic.
She yo-yos a lot in weight, I bet. I bet she yo-yos a lot.
Well, the ratings in radio will do that, David.
That will. I hear you.
So why don't we get into this? Melissa gets her on the phone.
Shh. She doesn't know she's on the radio.
All right. Don't tell her.
Okay, Melissa's going to call Aaron, and I need you to stay quiet because she doesn't know that you're listening in.
Okay, cool.
I got her. It's ringing. Hang on.
The old it's ringing.
Hello?
Hi, is Aaron there?
This is Aaron.
Hey, Aaron, my name is Melissa. How are you this morning?
I'm good.
Hey, I wanted to ask you something if you've got a minute. Is now a good time?
Yeah.
Well, you and I actually have a mutual friend named Craig, and rumor has it that you guys went out the other night, and I was just curious to find out how it went.
Oh, you know, he's been calling and texting, and I'm just not interested.
Yeah, but there's got to be a reason why. I mean, did you guys have a good time on your date?
You know, I've had a crush on him forever. It turned out
you're like, who is this?
Why would you give up all this info?
Exactly.
God, I hate this.
Can we really just put ourselves in the situation of a complete stranger cold calling you?
Right.
And then without even telling you really who they are, they give a name, but not any relationship to the guy.
Right.
Like, who are you? Where are you? And you just start babbling out all this fucking personal information. Would you do that?
How do you feel knowing that they tricked you in the beginning again?
They
almost got you.
I don't feel too good about myself right now.
No.
You know what, though? We were used to it from when they talk about fixing the console.
Right.
So we know what it's like to expect something and think it's real and then have it just turn into pure fantasy.
You know who is feeling good?
What?
The guy on their Facebook page, a photo of whom is posted, he's in front of his high school logo, it looks like.
Awesome Cougars.
And he's naked.
Uh-huh.
He's being quite awesome right there.
Well, yeah, he's got his legs pinned up against the wall, and he's filleting himself.
He's actually giving himself a blowjob right there.
Right.
Amazing.
All right, well, this is bullshit.
I've had a crush on him forever. It turned out he's just kind of like this passive, almost pussified, like, boring guy.
Really?
So, you know, while we were out, I kind of wondered, like, why I had ever had a crush on him. The date sucked.
Girl, what happened?
Girl, what happened?
Girl!
Girl.
Oh,
real girl. Talk. Real talk now,
oh,
girl.
Girl, you tell me what happened.
Who's this a photo of on her Facebook page?
Oh, no.
I have no idea.
I know who that is.
Okay, it says Anatomy of Jocktober, and it's pointing to different parts of this person's body. It's yeah. Hosts and stump boys and witty banter and phone scams, prep burger, the whole, keeping it local, War of the Roses, fugitives, song parodies. And what makes it fun is it's a big, fat body.
Ugh, disgusting.
Naked body.
Obese. And it's nude, and as it turns out, it's a photo of Terry Clifford.
Terry Clifford's a big, fat head
yeah.
With her Brady Bunch afro resting on top of it.
Let's leave the cliff alone.
Oh.
Well, here's the big reveal, guys. The big reveal on the second date thing. What were you thinking that day?
There's a photo op.
There's a Photoshop of Anthony and Jill Nicolini dressed as a cowboy and a cowgirl right under Don and Deirdre Imus dressed as a cowboy and a cowgirl.
We were in Nashville.
That's on Melissa's Facebook page.
That's great.
She's a fan of you, I guess.
Oh.
Here's the big reveal.
Well, he picked me up, and he was literally like, well, what do you want to do? And
wait, so he asked you out, and then he didn't have plans on where you guys were actually going?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, that's lame.
And the conversation was boring, and he was too quiet. And so we went to a bar, and he ordered a swishy, girly martini after I had ordered a beer.
It was a gin martini. It wasn't a swishy, girly drink. How is that
boy.
A girly drink?
Aaron, you're actually on second date on 103.7 Play.
Listen. I didn't know you were listening, and I don't know that I would have phrased some of these things so harshly if I knew that you were.
Wow.
And the voice is starting to sound familiar. That's like a War of the Roses voice,
probably
I think.
Heard the voice
yeah,
over the course of this
I'm sure
last
we've
month.
Heard all good. These voices.
One more clip here. Now an organic, real fight between two people who aren't faking.
Oh, yes. Wow.
That's what you're about to hear.
Okay.
You're really different when you're behind the bar. I mean, you're really charismatic. You're really attentive to everyone.
So what, you think you were just the most charming person on the date? It takes two to have a conversation, you know?
It's two to tango.
In Craig's defense, I mean, bartending for a cute girl and being on an actual date with a cute girl are two entirely different things.
He knows. She's bartender.
Hot. You know, she's hot. I'm not trying to get tips from her. She's a cute girl, but, you know, the conversation was terrible. It's like I was having a date with a cardboard cutout.
I mean, maybe we should try a second date.
Okay, so you're gonna give, well, I don't know if it's giving Craig another chance.
Give me
but
another
you're...
chance? Is that what you were about to say? No, there's going to be no second date. That's not going
to
happen.
So, Craig, Aaron wants to give it another shot to prove that you guys could work, and you don't even want to go there?
I'm not trying to be a jerk here, but it's just not going to happen. You know, I heard what she said while she thought I wasn't listening, so.
I think she used the word pussified.
Yeah, that probably sealed the deal, guys, so it's not going
to
happen.
I didn't want to go on the second date anyway, so.
You did,
I can't come to your bar anymore.
Well, she's not a good tipper anyway, so there you go.
All right.
Yes.
Tell me now. Okay, so this is awkward. You guys aren't going to see each other again, and there'll be no second date.
Done. Yeah, well, thanks for the help.
Second date on Mornings with Melissa and Jack.
Holy shit. At least it's not War of the Roses, I guess, right?
It is. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Holy fuck, that's horrible.
Photos we're laughing
at. We're not laughing at the radio bit. We're laughing at some of the postings on Facebook.
Oh, the postings are fantastic.
That's what gets us through that horrible audio.
Yeah, it's the same thing.
Oh, it's young Sam Roberts again.
It's just the same fucking formula as War of the Roses. They're just changing up the concept a little bit.
Oh, my God. That's terrible.
Oh, that's terrible.
So
yeah, it is exactly. You know what I think that is? I think that's War of the Roses if you don't want to pay to use War of the Roses.
Right.
Ah, there you go. Just get some people from around the office.
We're going to go back to Jocktober in a second, but we got a very important phone call coming in.
What?
Hello?
Hey, how you doing?
Oh, man.
Oh. Yeah.
No, we're not done with Jocktober.
Lady Di, you've been phone scammed.
I just did that to get a reaction out of Jimmy. It's my favorite thing.
Oh, that was so
great. We got Aziz outside the studio. That's why we got to stop Jocktober for now. But we'll go back into it at the big conclusion of today's Jocktober.
Yeah.
In a few minutes, but first, let's get Aziz in here. He's been patient for a minute or two outside the studio.
Bring him in. He's very famous.
He's extremely famous.
Yeah, he's sitting down now, and
is anybody?
He's just sitting, drinking water. Roland's out there. No one's listening enough to get us.
Well, we're not really allowed to have the show on outside.
No, I didn't want that on.
I don't want the show on.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah,
it's a big problem.
That almost got us sued.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
By an ex-employee.
Yes. Come on in there, sure.
What's up, buddy?
Seat.
How are you?
Take a seat. We're all just doing a radio show or some type of thing. Yeah, there's your headphones. Look
your
at that.
Is that your phone?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, that noise? No.
Yeah.
No.
Oh, those aren't your headphones.
Oh.
Ah, there they are. Answer. What is that?
What's that?
Wait. Is that coming out of Aziz's pocket?
No. Wait, it is. I was like, that's not mine, guys. Professional.
What were you listening to?
My phone.
It sounded familiar.
A random song, I don't know. I turned it off.
Definitely sounded familiar.
That was really freaking me out.
That was weird.
Yeah, no kidding. That was
creepy.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we were doing Jocktober. It's where we further alienate ourselves from the rest of the entertainment industry by just attacking other radio
shows. Yeah, other radio shows that, in our expert opinion, suck.
Yeah, we feel like we're the only ones that should be doing this.
That are worthy of mic time in any capacity.
Right, we should be on every single radio station.
Yes, well, this
you do
them show.
They're awful on the road. You got to go in there and just do, they want you to do your act. It doesn't
oh,
feel
my
right.
God, it's
That's
the worst.
That's got to be terrible.
Yeah, I did one in Miami one time, and a guy was like, I was tired, because, you know, if you're doing stand-up and stuff, you're up late doing shows and stuff, and, like, if you're doing shows late at night, like, that really wakes you up when you do a set. It's hard to, like, fall asleep after that. And so if you're a comic, you're generally going to be tired when you do these shows. And the guy was so mad that I was tired. He's like, hey, man, you better be funny. Like, let's get it going. And I was like, all right. You know what? It's
oh,
best when you just have
man.
Like have a conversation and, you know, things just come up that are funny.
Yeah.
Wait, and did he actually say you better be funny?
Yeah, he said something like, wake up, man.
You on better, the air he yeah, said this?
No, in between.
Yeah,
and
but
then,
still,
like, I was sitting there, I was like, all right, man, it'll be fine. And then at a certain point, like, they just brought out this, like, big fat dude and they, like, put butter on his belly and that was, like,
boy.
A segment. And I was like, I gotta get out of here.
Oh,
like this
the
is,
old
this
butter
is...
on the belly segment.
Yeah, I mean, what do you do with that?
What was
yeah.
At that point, it's like, well,
was there a payoff?
This isn't my audience.
Yeah, what was the bit? Maybe we...
you just gave us an idea.
Right. Let's not judge. We don't really know what
was the
cool,
butter
cool
on the
was.
Belly thing? What the hell could they possibly have been doing?
Yeah, I wonder what the end game is there.
Right. What the fuck?
Sometimes you go in and they have things planned. Like, I was on Cowhead one time in Tampa, who we love.
Yeah, we like the Cowhead.
As I'm on the thing, they brought in these girls. They were eating dog food on Aww. Their hands and knees out of a bowl, and I'm like, I was
you
like,
can't
all right,
compete
I,
with that.
Yeah, what do I do with that?
Right.
You know, I sat there with an erection like everybody, but it was just, but it's the worst when they expect you to do your act, and they're like, well, where do you want us to lead you? What do you want to talk about? And it's like, dude, just chat.
Yeah. See what happens, you know?
Have a little chit.
See what pops up.
Indeed.
Yeah. You got a special coming out on Netflix.
Yes, it comes out November 1st.
Friday.
Yeah, very excited, yeah.
That Netflix is just a booming thing. It's taking off, amazing. People are going there for first-run stuff like comedy specials and TV shows.
Yeah.
You know, it was just pretty much Blockbuster where you didn't have to go to the store
right.
for a while. Now, original,
you had to wait for your stuff.
Original programming. Well, that was it. At the beginning, it was
you
go to the website. You would, you're
mailing stuff,
they
no.
They send you a DVD.
Got to mail that one back before they send the other one. I hated that.
And I would never mail things.
Yeah.
Back.
Right.
It's
weird because like they used to just, like, profit so much off laziness. Like,
right.
I would be like, all right, I need to get, like, these, you know, like, when you get kind of homework movies, like, oh, you know, I've never seen Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf or anything like that, I'll watch that soon, and then you just have them sitting there, and you're just like, I'll just watch Kindergarten Cop on HBO instead. Keep these DVDs. I'll watch them eventually, and then it's just, like, a year.
At Blockbuster, I must have given them probably 10 times more money in late fees than I did in actual video rentals.
Because I would just have them sitting there and be like, I'll take it back tomorrow. Right. And then I just wouldn't take them back. And then you try to dump it into the deposit thing and run so the person doesn't look at you. Thank God that's done.
But I remember the high of going into Blockbuster and seeing all the new
releases.
Like the new release box covers are the one I wanted to see. And they always guaranteed that they'd have copies.
Yeah.
Oh, it was wonderful. Yeah,
the wall would always look the same. And then you're right. All of a sudden it was like another color would hit you. Like, whoa, that's a green color. What
that's
the
new that's movie. A new movie.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm so excited.
I remember I used to like, you would have to call to like see if they had the video in stock.
And
I grew up in South Carolina where it's so boring, so you would love to see a movie or any kind of depiction of another place more interesting. So I would just call constantly to see if they had stuff in stock, and it's so interesting. Now it's like kids don't have to do
there's so many different places to get it. Right. You could just illegally get them. Or on demand now gets them pretty quickly after the movie even comes out. And then Netflix, of course, Hulu, there's a bunch of places.
I thought if that's like made kids cooler now, because I remember, you know, now kids can watch anything. They can watch, you know, the coolest stuff. You know, they can watch, you know, a Scorsese movie, or they can watch, you know, Mr. Show or whatever. Like the coolest stuff is available to watch instantly. And when I was a kid, it was like, you had to watch like the garbage that was like Full House or whatever, or you're just like not watching anything.
Yeah, so
it's like, well, I'll do this over just nothing. You're forced to ingest it. I wonder. I hope kids are now like taking advantage of the fact that they can kind of watch anything they want.
Instead of Full House, you're watching Mean Streets. That's 6 year old.
It was such a fantasy, such a futuristic dream. To be able to choose what you watched when you wanted to watch it. And that was only on television. Now the thought that you can just bring your phone and watch a movie on the shitter if you want, you know, it was, I used to imagine what it would be like to have like a watch with a TV on it. When I was a kid, and just be like, oh, I could watch TV, you know, that would be the coolest thing.
You ever think we would get to that point?
Never think, no.
Unbelievable.
And by the way, that fantasy just included what was being broadcast at that time.
Right.
So, you know, I'd watch the noon news at school and sit there, and it would be an amazing fantasy to think about. But now, you know, I could go HBO Go if I want to and just fucking watch shit for, I got a sling box set up. I could watch my own fucking television on this thing.
I got one 2 years ago from my manager. I never hooked it up
sling box?
Yeah, it just seemed too bitey. It wouldn't work.
It is so fucking good. I could pop any channel on my Fios system on this phone right this second.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Just watch it. Hey. Here you go. Right from my home.
I'm a VCR guy. Oh, I hate people that resist technology. You know what? You give me a VCR and a good movie.
You know, I don't know much. Hey, that noon, it's still blinking. You know, 12 noon. What do I...
Aziz said something in there, though. You come from a boring town. So how did you make it? It had to be a lot tougher.
I went to school at NYU, so I moved to New York.
Oh, okay. That was the big jump.
I always admire people that just have moved to New York just to, like, they're like, I'm going to become a comedian. It's like, wow, you
that
are
is
a fucking brave
the
person.
Balls of that.
Yeah. Move. Right.
I was here at school, and, you know, there's all these other kids that are at school at the same time. You're all kind of going through New York at the same time. You have all these other kids. And then you think about, you know, I know comics that have just, like, moved here with nothing, and they're just like, I'm going to become a comedian, and they fucking do it somehow. It's incredible.
What were you, film, right?
Hmm?
Were you doing the film thing? No?
I didn't know what I wanted to do, and so I went to the business school, because I was like, start a business or something. And then I got to the business school, and I was like, oh, my God, I hate every single person here. All these kids that wanted to do finance and all that stuff. Like, I didn't even know what, like, Goldman Sachs and stuff was, and they're all, like, so fired up about this stuff, and I was going to transfer to the film school a couple times, and I just got too lazy. It was like, oh, you got to put a portfolio together, and I was like, whatever.
So how do you make
that terrible decision? actually, it didn't matter. I mean, but...
Right,
But how do you make the jump to comedy and entertainment, then, in that position?
I just started doing stand-up when I was in college, like the summer of my freshman year. I just started doing stand-up, and, you know, I really enjoyed it, and I just kept kind of...
My people are like, you're funny, dude.
I mean, pretty much, yeah.
You got it, fuck. You should be on stage.
Yeah, nine times out of ten, they shouldn't be.
Yeah. That's pretty impressive, though.
People really love it. It's interesting to watch them walk on at the Cellar. Because it's an amazing, and I've kind of seen a change over the years, you know, when you know somebody and you watch them gain success, and it's an amazing ovation, and it's always silent, and I mean that like when you're setting up a joke, people always
silent after
no. I mean that they laugh, but I mean that they're always paying attention to what you're saying, like they really enjoy you. There's something about you that people just genuinely like when you're on stage.
Oh, well, thanks.
And it makes me want to scream in the back, because you never want to see another comedian being loved.
Of course.
It's just painful to watch.
That is a big brother that just passed by. I think he's going into Shade 45.
Oh, probably.
Who was that?
Was he a player or a bodyguard?
Could have been him. Well, that's true, too. You don't know if
right
it looks like
him.
Wow, I see a giant shadow.
I think he's just a black dude.
He's a big black dude. That is just a black dude. That's a big guy.
I think he's just a black guy that's just in the serious offices.
Right, yes. There could be a black gentleman in the hallway.
If that's a bodyguard, it's like, come on, man. There's bigger black dudes to be bodyguards.
That's true, too.
Roland's looking at him. No, something's going on over there.
Yeah, Roland. Yeah. Let's call Roland. We always, because once in a while, we'll have a really cool guest walk in that we'll try to hijack. Or we'll
all
try
right,
to,
here comes Roland.
Let's
we'll
see who
see
that
what
is.
The deal is.
Roland, what's going on at Shade?
It's a T.I. with the game.
T.I.
Oh, the game?
I don't know. Another two people.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, I don't know who they are.
Okay. You don't know who they are?
T.I. with the game.
Come on. This is the dummy, Roland. This is the guy who books our show talent-wise.
He's amazing at it, but we don't understand
this
why.
This is how pop culture ignorant he is. We were walking into MTV press junket, if I was doing, and we see somebody who looks kind of famous, and he was not kidding. He goes, that's Jay-Z. I'm like, really? He goes, yes, that's him. It was the guy fucking wanding people as we walked in. But he wasn't being ironic. He really thought. He just says things and hopes that it sticks.
Jay-Z.
Well, he can't see. You know that, right? Roland can't see.
Are you blind, too?
Yes.
Roland?
He needs glasses badly.
I'm blind.
Another reason why he falls asleep at movies.
And then when he came to my party during the summer, we're all going in the pool and stuff. It's like, Roland, go in the pool. He goes in the pool, and it's like, well, swim over here at the deep end. I can't swim. He can't swim. He's blind.
He's a disaster.
Little kid. He was staying in the little shallow end, put little swimmies on him.
Aw,
adorable.
But you're also doing the 92nd Street Y?
Oh, yeah.
What a smart place for a gig. I've gone to a couple. Ooh. I saw Poitier speak there, or Poitier, however you say it.
Sidney Poitier.
Yeah.
Yes, that fine actor.
I saw him in L.A. one time. I was going to eat sushi with a friend, and I saw him just sit and eat sushi by himself.
Mm.
And it was like, he did a really good job. It was
very elegant, very gentlemanly.
Was everybody? I saw him in a pharmacy in L.A. I had stopped in on a lark going on the way to the hotel. You know how it is. You got to pick up a little Viagra because you forgot yours, and L.A. is a big act-out town. And I saw him in the Beverly Hills pharmacy, just fucking buying something. So I bugged him for a photo. He was very nice. But it was like, you know, no one gave a shit. I'm like, how do you not know who this is?
It's weird when you see, like, these, like, you know, older, like, kind of legendary dudes, like, walking around doing, you know, the most mundane
just
shit.
Nothingness. Just, yeah, you expect them to be, you know, parties or something.
Yeah.
Some kind of an event.
Mm. But a regular actor I can understand, but this guy is a guy that any single person in that business would cancel plans to eat with. Mm. Like, anybody in the business would cancel what they were doing to have dinner with Sidney Poitier.
Yeah, yeah.
He's just...
it's just like... You're always going to be alone. That's the message.
That's the message right there.
That's the lesson.
And you see him eating sushi by himself. That just makes me sad.
In the end, you die in your own arms.
Yeah, you want to think like, oh, once you do like really great things and stuff, you move beyond all the garbage that, you know, I'm doing. And then you see people in your world. You're like, what? Isn't there another world you can graduate to?
Yeah, something.
The same shit.
We saw Christopher Walken getting takeout one night.
Oh, remember
in California.
That?
Yeah, we Sunset were having dinner Boulevard. Somewhere. And he walked in. And he's getting just bags of takeout.
I forgot
and he
all
did
about
that slow turn and looked over his shoulder to see who was looking at him.
He was in character
big,
for that movie.
Tall
the,
guy.
The long black leather jacket
yeah,
on.
Yeah, it was cool.
Oh, the, that, I love those movies, the where he plays the Archangel. Is it Gabriel or Michael?
Oh, yes, that was it.
That's how long ago it was, yeah.
The, Prophecies.
Yeah, Prophecy.
I like those movies. That was fucking, he was great in those.
Especially the first one was really good.
I forgot about that.
Did you see him?
I might have to revisit those.
Yeah, he plays the Archangel. The guy who played the devil's a little douchey and really enjoying playing the
over
devil.
Over the top.
Yeah, like a little, ooh, the evil guy with the beard.
The only over the top devil I want to see is Pacino.
Yeah.
He's an absentee landlord! All right. Yeah, he's a screaming guy. We get it.
I liked Keanu Reeves in that movie, though. I thought he was fucking...
Yeah, he
was good.
Fit the bill.
I liked that movie. It was all right.
Kevin
the
Lomax.
Was a little over the top.
Yes, right. That's yeah. it. That was a good one.
And I really relate.
That's like... I can do
that.
Like,
okay, that's where the name comes from. Okay.
Oh.
No.
Oh, yeah,
Aziz
okay.
knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Okay. Ooh.
That's one of my random things I can do an impression of is like Kevin Lomax from The Devil's Advocate.
Yeah.
Now I'm like, now you're going
to
be like, do it.
Now we
no,
have
we're
to.
Like the DJs in Miami. Come on, let's go.
Yeah.
Come
on,
perform. Where's that fat guy, Butter?
You're
yeah, I want to hear Kevin Lomax.
Before we get to the Butter guy.
I'm an attorney. My name is Kevin Lomax. Milton. Kevin. Oh God! What if I just did all of Devil's Advocate? Right? I've seen that movie. Isn't it weird? Like certain movies that are like okay movies, and you end up seeing them like a million times.
Yeah.
Because there's something about him you like. Like I loved Pacino in that, even though he was over the top. And
oh, no, it's yeah. fun. It's a fun movie to watch.
It is. It's yeah. There are certain movies that are so easy to watch. You know them. Sometimes you don't want to put too much thought into something. Or if I know if I'm going to sleep, I'll put something on that I've seen 1,000 times because I know I could just shut my eyes, listen, and kind of run it through my head while I doze, while I drift off to sleep.
I can't do that. I have to have silence when I sleep.
Complete silence.
I cannot have
crazy.
TV on.
Do
you doze during like... a Voth show?
It's hard to sleep with a noose around my neck.
Teasing, of course. Rich is great.
Are you a good sleeper? Or are you a peace? You seem like a peace. I've never seen you upset.
You never see me upset? I don't get that upset. I sleep all right, I guess. When I'm in New York, I don't sleep as well because I'm up late doing spots and stuff. In L.A., you know, I'm filming and things like that, so I have to get up early, so I'm used to going to bed a little bit early.
You're quite a good actor, too. Aziz is like a really natural good actor.
No, I'm not.
No, you are.
Acting is it's not that hard. You know, like, I was thinking about this, that movie, did you guys see Captain Phillips?
Oh, yeah. So the boat movie.
Yeah, so the guy who plays, like, the lead Somali pirate. Like,
yeah.
He was great, right? He was great. They're talking about he might get nominated for an Oscar or something.
Yeah.
He was a cab driver.
He's just a guy.
He was just a cab driver. He'd never acted before or anything.
Yeah,
What other field can you just instantly become one of the best? There's no way that would happen in stand-up.
No.
Yeah, no way true. That would happen in radio. Nothing where it's like, well, he was just doing, you know, he worked at Target, and then now he has the number one radio show, like, a month later. It's like, no, it doesn't happen.
Yeah, acting is the only thing you can all of a sudden incidentally be good at. That and prostitution. Probably two jobs. You can go from doing something else to being really good at really
immediately.
Fast.
Man, did that guy look the part?
He was amazing.
He just looked
so
like a
scary.
Beat up Somali pirate. He really
great.
Did. Yeah.
And the most famous line, you know, is that when he's like, "I'm the captain now." Or
yeah.
He improvised that. That wasn't in the script.
Really?
Yeah.
He's fucking rewriting.
Not trying to take away anything from that guy. I mean, he was incredible. I just think it's amazing that like
he could do that.
Yeah, it was like, oh, he just came in and now
how was he
like,
discovered
with Tom Hanks? I think they just like did like a big casting call, you know,
get a bunch of white guys over there and said, like, just pick out the scariest looking guy. Who would you be scared of? Yeah, look at him. He's a real slight guy, too.
Well, there's probably not too many Somali actors that are capable, so they probably just did like an open casting and said, let's see who we can get.
Look, Tom Hanks looks scared in that picture.
We'll act for Sandwich. That guy is thin.
In that publicity shot, Hanks looks scared.
Wow. I think he lives in like Philadelphia or something. He was in some city there doing a big casting call. He lived in the States.
And someone probably told him, hey, they're looking for guys who are Somali, and he came. Well, that
looks like Michael K. Williams a little
dream
bit.
Dream come true. Right? Yes, you know what? Watching the movie, he reminded me of Michael K. Williams a lot. Yeah.
Well,
don't think they all look alike. Just, well, but in this case,
he kind of reminded me of him too.
He looks a little
too.
Bit like Michael K. Williams from The Wire. Yeah.
Who's getting a lot of fucking action in Boardwalk Empire this year? I don't know. You don't keep up with it?
I have not delved into it.
It's good, man. Did you watch it?
No, I haven't, but I heard it's good.
Yeah, the series got better. Like HBO series, I can lock. I can't lock into like much from Showtime, but HBO, I can fucking. Game of Thrones. I can lock into
Game of Thrones. I watch.
It's hard to jump in to a new series. Like Breaking Bad was all the rage there. I was right on board with that, and then that finishes up, and I'm kind of like, you know, you really got to commit when you go with a series that's been on for a couple of years too. Yeah. You got to commit to sitting there for hours on end doing those marathons. To really get up to speed. You can't just casually start watching one of these shows again.
Now, I feel like there has to be such a groundswell of people telling you, like, oh, this is the most. Right. That's the only way I'll start, because it's like, sometimes you start these shows, and then it gets really dumb in, like, the third or fourth season. You're like, why did I fucking invest 30 hours with you, stupid
asshole
show?
Told me to fucking watch this? Yeah.
Did you start anything that you didn't like?
I don't want to say. I feel bad. Not really. Usually,
I don't
usually
have
like.
I know.
See
weird?
What that is. See what he
that's
just did.
Opie, people, man.
Opie did it. Aziz did it. And Jimmy.
Can't wait
Jimmy
to can
do
that
it
stuff
too.
Out.
Me and Opie will sit there and just shit on anything without any thought that maybe down the road we might be fucking insulting somebody.
Maybe that's why we don't get as many opportunities.
That could probably.
See, it might be smarter to do it there.
Of course it's smarter.
And there's also like a mentality where like some people just don't like to insult other people. Like, Aziz is just a nice guy who doesn't like to hurt people's feelings and insult people. And I'm an insensitive.
Well, he wouldn't be good at radio then.
Right, yeah, you got to kind of be a creep to do this every day.
Probably goes home and pulls wings off a butterfly.
Yeah, he does. Something will come out about Aziz that's just truly terrible. Like, he would put nails in the crib. What? He would videotape thumbtacks in the crib.
I don't like insulting TV shows, though. It's just not my thing. Nails in the crib.
That's mean, you know.
Those babies have never
done any good. Gunny sack full of kittens. He's going down to the river.
But you do get embarrassed when you bump into somebody that you've shit on.
Well, you had one of the big ones.
That's the situation that I avoid. Because now you never know, like, what's going to get picked up. Like,
all these
blogs and stuff are just looking to fill space. Like, you just.
Oh, and they're waiting for someone to trip up.
Mm-hmm. Like, oh, God. Like, man. Like, that girl that was at that Halloween party that had the blackface on, like.
Yeah, yeah.
I saw that. I was like, man, well, they're covered for like a couple of days. They could do the apology. They could do everyone's thoughts on the apology. Yeah. Everyone's thoughts on blackface.
Juliana Hall.
What was she doing?
Juliana Hall. She was. They were doing the cast of Orange is the New Black. They were doing like a bunch of girls dressing like the cast of Orange is the New Black. And she was that crazy eye girl. So
she put on blackface. And they had like all her friends and stuff, and I think she was the only like, you know, actress like person out of the group. And they're like, all right, who should do the blackface bit? And let's pick her.
There's all the girls. Now here's the thing: I don't see any fucking problem.
Zero
with that.
Problem.
Because she's dressing as someone. If the person you're dressing as is a black person, I mean, you gotta. Change your skin tone.
You gotta
tone.
Go all in.
I'm not like offended by that really that much. I think it's like, oh, you know, you're gonna get in trouble. For
but
doing
that's
that.
Just it. Like, she should know she's gonna get in trouble.
Right.
But the whole thing that she's gonna get in trouble irks me. I understand if someone puts on fucking mammy makeup and starts going, "Mammy, how I love your hand," doing an old minstrel show type of thing.
Not what that
that's
is.
A little more offensive than that. But if you're legitimately dressing up, they had a couple of guys and they were dressed as two basketball players from a photo that was put online. It was two real, you know, NBA guys. And these two guys were both white guys, and it was one white ball player, one black ball player. The black ball player's got his, like, elbows on the other guy's shoulder, looking over the top of his head. So they recreated that. The one guy had to put on blackface makeup. I think somebody...
He didn't have to.
he didn't. But he did to recreate the picture, I guess. And then it was tweeted. The picture was tweeted by some NBA entity who immediately, like, they were like, wow, this is a great representation of this photo. Immediately, we regret that we said this, we apologize. They apologized, but meanwhile, it's like they were recreating the photo.
Because again, you got to look at context.
Nobody comes out and just gives a rational explanation. Like, no. When you're the difference in intent between,
all right, that's doing,
like you said, doing a minstrel show and just being mocking and shitty,
yeah,
and portraying a legit TV character, they are tremendously different intents and different
exactly.
things. And the fact is, nobody comes out and defends themselves properly. She should have come out and said, look, I'm not sorry. It's an impression of a character who I like on television.
Right.
It was a Halloween costume.
I'm dressing as them.
And if you can't see the difference between me being a Halloween character,
right.
of a character I admire,
right.
and a minstrel show, then shame on you.
Or there's other people getting in a lot of jam-ups here because they're going as Trayvon. So they put makeup on.
Jesus,
put blackface on,
wow,
put a hoodie on with blood, and they got Skittles
well,
on
that guy's
cake.
Just trying to be an asshole, let's be honest. I mean, come on.
Trying to be an asshole.
You know the difference.
Now yeah. that obviously...
just trying to be a dick.
It's insensitive,
oh
it's inciting.
God.
Yeah.
The guy in blackface with a hoodie with a red splotch in the front of it.
And another guy with neighborhood watch on his shirt, pointing his fingers at his head like a gun.
God.
I mean, obviously, that's offensive. It's inciting people. It doesn't have the same thing as Juliana Hough doing what she did, or Hoag, or Hoggle. The G-H really confuses me. H-O-U-G-A. Well, her whole name is Hoggle.
It's so weird, like, you know, all this kind of crazy stuff used to happen, and we just didn't know about
yes,
it as much.
Exactly.
And now it's like anything like crazy offensive like this just goes viral, and the person's
yes.
life gets
is destroyed.
That guy's... I mean, who's going to hire that guy for any job? Like, everyone... I've never hired someone for, like, a job,
uh-huh.
but
you
I'm
hire
sure
that
you
guy?
Google everyone.
You Google,
and that's
yes.
going to be the first thing. It's like,
gonna
well,
be like, oh,
you're fantastic, and
this
you're...
This Trayvon...
I really want you to be the architect for my house, but
yeah.
I just saw your Halloween costume.
I saw... You remember 12 years ago,
right.
Halloween, when you did the black movie, because it never goes away.
God.
Yeah, I have a little problem
and,
with that.
You know, and part of me is like, oh, good, man, fuck that guy. And then part of me is like, God, that's the rest of his life.
Rest of your life.
Any mistake, like, you know, there's...
Yeah.
Like...
See, uh-huh. offensive Halloween costumes have always been a part of it, though. Like, I remember when Chris...
Yeah.
I laughed so hard and I was in the Village, and a guy was walking around with a Superman outfit, and he had a wheelchair attached to the front of him, and I'm like, the genius of that. But there's always, like, whatever happens that's brutal during the year,
yeah.
there's going to be a Halloween, whether it was 9/11, like, whatever horrible tragedy, somebody will have a fairly clever Halloween costume depicting
yes.
that event or
yeah.
mocking... And that's even a part of it. It's just such a...
We've always had it, but like Aziz is saying, now it goes viral so quickly.
So many people that had crazy offensive, like 9/11 type costumes, but we just didn't see them
because
this has become a thing in the last few years.
Only the people at the party and maybe a couple pictures got out for the local people, you know.
How many dead JonBenets were around for Halloween?
Absolutely.
I mean, what's more offensive than being dressed as a murdered child?
So this year is the Trayvon?
This Trayvon is
the go-to for the...
Huge offensive. That's the go-to offensive.
I think that's got to be the number one go-to offensive Halloween costume this year.
Anything you could think of.
You think you're
going to
have one of these at your party this Friday?
You know what? I don't know. I would hope not.
Is the lady in the middle supposed to be George Zimmerman's wife? Who is she?
I don't know what she is. She's dressed like
a
river dance girl or something.
Right.
God.
An Irish girl.
Oh, God. I just can't believe it. Every time I see it, I'm just like, this was done. This happened. Like,
and he went with the real black face. He didn't go with the...
The realistic,
right.
like
right, the brown,
pretty much look like me. Like,
she browned
like,
herself
yeah.
up. Yeah. He's using the old vaudevillian, burn a cork and rub it on your
right.
face, blackface.
And there's also Robert Downey Jr., who brilliantly portrayed a black guy in that film.
Oh, in Tropic Thunder. That was so great.
Amazing.
Yeah,
but why is that allowed? And why is that above
he
reproach?
Got some shit for that.
But I mean, not where it would have counted.
Right.
Not job threatening.
Not where it would have counted because he's Robert Downey Jr. and he's a genius actor. But, like, what is the difference? Why is that acceptable? It's because he played a character. Well, you know what I mean? It's like, right. What she was doing was totally legit.
Yeah.
The Wayans brothers did, and I understand whiteface wasn't a big thing, didn't offend
white
me.
White girls, yeah.
Yeah, white girls. But you got to look at different levels.
Yeah, that thing, I didn't see that and have any kind of reaction to it. It was just like, oh, it's more like, oh, this is a dumb thing that's going to be in the news for a couple of
days. No one wants to look at context anymore and intent and things like that. They'll lump her to it. There are people that will lump her doing that in the same category as the guy doing the Trayvon, which is ridiculous.
Well, what was the thing? Like, didn't Sarah Silverman go on, like, Conan or something, and she was doing a joke that was, you know, against, you know, Asian racism? But in the joke, she says, like, Ching Chong Bing Bong or something.
Uh-huh. She also said,
Or she said chink. Or something. And the joke was, like, a pro, you know, Asian, like, it was like a commentary.
But that gets lost
and
in
then they just, those groups that are just, like, just waiting for something, saw it, just didn't look at, like, what she was actually saying.
Right.
And then just, like, gave her a bunch of hell. And it's like, come on. Mm-hmm. Like, and that's always a bummer when those groups, you know, just have those knee-jerk reactions.
They hold people hostage. They hold people hostage, their careers. And it's amazing they have that kind of power. People just tell them to go fuck themselves. You know, fuck you.
Going with your thought, you guys ever have problems with Parks and Rec? Anything that has gone on there?
No, nothing.
Or something you wanted to do and people were like, no way, this is going to cause too much of an issue out there.
No, nothing ever on Parks. I'm trying to think of anything I've done in stand-up or anything as a
You were part of a great comedy. Aziz is one of my favorite comedies, which was fucking Seth Rogen. Oh, God. Observe and Report with Leota.
We love that movie.
Fucking
way better than Mall Cop.
Hilarious.
That's the movie you make if you're doing the whole mall thing.
Yeah, yeah, that's brutal. Funny.
We love that movie.
Fucking great.
I think I'm ready to watch that again.
But that did a lot of things that you thought, like, especially, I loved the Anna Faris scene where she was drunk and vomiting and fucks her anyway. God, it was fantastic.
That was
real comedy right there.
Because you suspend disbelief in a comedy just like you do in a cop drama.
Of course.
Like, nobody thinks that Mel Gibson's really a police officer or Schwarzenegger's really a robot. Why do you think that somebody really means a racist comment if they say it in a comedy or a homophobic comment?
Yep. Right.
Why can't you suspend disbelief there?
It just has become this thing that these groups have to do. They jump on it and get attention for their group. It's ridiculous.
Well, as a society, we all accept it, though. That's the problem. We were discussing earlier. We all got to speak up more about it.
Because nobody defends
it. Because it's not the majority. It's the minority. I truly believe that.
What are you saying?
It's the minority that is getting all the attention. I don't believe the masses are that offended by this stuff we've been discussing today.
Yeah.
Not even close to the majority of
people.
It's like,
it's really like the news outlets create these stories about outrage, and it kind of gives this perception that there's a bunch of people upset about something when it's really, it's just like filling up space about stuff. Yeah. And it's kind of like, I saw, there was the Indian woman won the Miss America contest, and then, like, people tweeted racist stuff, and it's like a few hundred people tweeted racist stuff, okay? And then that became this big news story, and it, like, put a cloud over what she did.
Yeah, yeah.
And
her
it's
accomplishment.
Like, well, you know, why? Who cares if someone tweeted? That means they get to get on the news? Like, I mean, if it happened, like, 10 years ago, they would have said the racist stuff at home. There wouldn't be a record of it for them to, like, make a news story out of it. And it gives this perception, like, oh, well, the whole country is so racist because the Indian person can't even win the contest, and now all these people are tweeting racist stuff.
And it was, you know, inconsequential, the number of people that
actually did that.
It was nothing.
Yeah,
that's a great point.
Yeah, you're always going to get that, no matter what it is.
I don't know why they have such power. I guess because it makes a good story, obviously, for
the news loves it.
The news people have to fill up their time.
It's just trying to come up with some sort of headline that people will click on.
Right.
Could you imagine these? I mean, when you think about it from their side, even though they're despicable fucking animals that run the news, you got 24-hour news cycles. You're constantly in need of news.
Yeah.
Like, these guys have built these creatures that need to be fed 24 hours a day.
Yeah.
So they're grabbing anything they can, pumping it up to make it interesting, because if you just take it as it is, most of these stories, if you really research them, aren't half as interesting or exciting as they make them out to be.
Yeah, I sometimes even feel that. Like, I'll see a headline, and I read all the shit, and I try my best not to. I try to stay off my phone, and I'll read that stuff, but, you know, every now and then you get bored, and you do it, and sometimes you'll see that outrageous headline, and you'll click it, and then you'll read it and be like, oh,
it's not even near that. Yes!
I'm kind of bummed.
Yeah. Especially when you go to, like, news sites, like Drudge is one where you'll click on a headline, it'll be very exciting, and then you realize it's like, no... It says possibly, you like the words like, well, you know,
people are saying
it's things like, you know, meteor on course for, you know, Earth. And it's like, oh, well, this will be the closest that anything's passed since last week.
Right.
You know, and then it's like,
we're going to miss us by a million miles.
Yeah, yeah.
When Obama does the Tonight Show, it's funny because, you know, because Jay likes Obama, and I know he likes Obama. But the headline on Drudge has read, Leno versus Obama. Yeah. Like on the up of the night before the show. And it's like, this is not going to be a big war. I remember when Carlin did it with Ann Coulter. And the headline was Carlin versus Coulter. And I had seen Ann after that, and I'm like, how was it doing it with Carlin? And she's like, he was lovely, such a nice man. Like, she couldn't stop raving about how sweet George Carlin was. There was no fight. There was just two people who did a talk show together.
Yeah.
But they make it into something.
Yeah, well, that's just it. They have to keep shoveling coal into the burners.
But it's we're all full of shit because, you know, like, we know that information is, like you said, zapped out there, and it's irretractable, and we can never be taken back. And we're all living with this new set of rules, and we're all vulnerable to it for something that we normally don't see coming, and yet we don't give each other a break on it. Like, it's almost like if we were all in a movie together, and then we were holding each other accountable for the crimes committed in the movie.
By the
like, how fake are the other actors to not understand that we're all in this together? Like, and we can't tell the difference between a guy that does something legitimately hateful and a guy that slips up in a joke.
Does it for complete entertainment.
I don't believe it. We do know the difference. We just seem to like to watch each other swing by the neck. It's a real sickness. Yeah.
Well, when you're watching someone swinging, it ain't you.
Yeah.
So it's a lot nicer that way. So point the finger and accuse other people
of things. Speaking of hateful diatribes, did I say it wrong? Aziz is special. Filled with hate. it's on Netflix. I don't have the paper in front of me. It is. When is it on Netflix?
Friday.
November 1st.
Oh, okay. Oh, Friday night. Okay. November and it's, what's it called?
At midnight or 12:01 or whatever.
You have a bunch of specials. Which one is this?
This one's it's called Buried Alive.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is this the one I saw that you... It was on Comedy Central last year or whatever, or no?
No, this is another one.
Jesus, you pump out all the material. Is this a Netflix exclusive?
Yeah, it is.
So you're doing it directly for them. It's not going to be seen anywhere else.
After a few months, I'm going to do the $5 download. If you don't have Netflix and you want to buy it, like I did the last one, you can do that.
Because some people don't have Netflix does that when you do a $5 download or whatever you do, can people get that in other countries? They can, right?
Oh, yeah, okay. And Netflix is kind of worldwide now too.
Yeah. So you're making a lot of $5.
Yeah, I mean, it's great because people want to own it.
A lot of $5.
Yeah. So it'll come out like 6 months after that.
And you could also see Aziz performing this Friday, November the 1st, the same night, at the Kaufman Concert Hall at the 92nd Street Y.
I'm not performing that. I'm just doing a talk.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were doing a talk. Wow. All right.
Or like, you know, interview thing. I'm not doing stand-up at that.
Yeah, no.
Just don't want anyone to come and be like, well, Norton said you're going to perform.
What happened? Fucking Jim.
The four people.
And don't forget Parks and Rec.
That very specific situation happens too.
Yeah. I'm happy to see my friend be giving a talk in the same place I saw Gene Wilder and Sidney Poitier. I'm happy to be.
Oh.
How are those? It must have been fantastic.
Gene
right?
Wilder was better. Sidney Poitier was a good talker, but he didn't talk about Hollywood. He talked about his mother and his upbringing. And I guess, again, he's so fucking bored.
That would be kind of... You didn't like that?
I didn't mind it, but I wanted to hear
so
more
different.
About...
I want to hear him talk about A Patch of Blue.
But a black actor, he won the first black Oscar. Like, I'd be much more interested to hear about the racism he faced in Hollywood.
Guess Who's Coming to Dinner.
Yeah, or his impressions of those roles now. And because to me, like, he's not just some douchey actor, like, all right, he made movies. I'd be interested to hear what it was like for him, and was his perspective any different because he's from the Caribbean? I would love to have heard that. But whatever. Wilder, I thought, was amazing. What a nice man. He's a lovely man, Gene Wilder.
And Parks and Rec coming back. There was a weird thing with that. We went over with, what's his
Nick
name?
Nick Offerman was on yesterday.
Nick Offerman was on. He was great.
Yeah,
he was a lot of fun.
That guy's the best, man.
First time we met him, he's a cool dude.
Very cool guy.
And he explained the whole Parks and Rec thing because they blew it out of proportion, like, you know.
Yeah, it's exactly what we were talking about earlier.
And everyone's like, man, why'd you show up here? Right. It's like, it's hot, man. Those places just need something to write about. It's the same. I think it's like the same.
They've been wrestling for a couple weeks and trying out a few little things. And, yeah. And it's coming back officially November 14th. So
yeah. More crap, just like we were talking about.
Yeah, exactly.
They latch on, make up their own story, and then run with it.
Sam pointed out something I heard on the after show yesterday, which was a good point about Nick Offerman. Which you noticed something that we had never seen.
Oh, yeah.
When he started laughing. Wacky laugh. He has the same, like, sort of cadence and everything that he does on the show that's, like, so straightforward.
His laugh went like...
yeah. And then he had a very giggle.
It's very,
very giddy laugh.
Yeah, yeah.
So
very
it took him right out of it. Like,
yeah, yeah.
He does it as Ron every now and then. There's like maybe like once a season. There's something that makes Ron like giddy.
Yeah.
And when he does that, it's so funny to me. He's such a great guy. Like you know, there are times where that whole cast. It's so many great people. Like when I go to work, sometimes it's like, man, it's really not gonna get better than this. I gotta cherish this gig while I have it.
That's smart thinking. Enjoy the gig while you have it, because everyone thinks the next gig is around the corner, and it's like it's smart to enjoy it.
Yeah, and you know, you work on these big shows and movies and things like that, and there's always usually someone who's just like a real dick.
Pain
and
the ass.
On this, it's like everyone's just great, and you just have a fun time. And I don't know, everyone fucking says, "Oh, we're all friends, whatever."
Everybody is so wonderful.
It's true. It's a good group of folks.
You know, like after the show's over, you get the real stories.
Yeah. Well, like Chevy Chase, like there was rumors that he was awful on
every Community.
Yeah, on every
exactly on every.
What are you kidding me? We've been hearing that for 25 years.
But it's like, dude, what are you so miserable about? Like, you know, you're an older guy. You've had a long and very very solid film career and TV career, and you're on another. A well-respected show? Like, what's the problem? Fucking...
Yeah. What could be the issue, right?
Just enjoy it.
Yeah.
He's always an issue from what I hear, but... Well. Hey, I never worked with him. What do I know?
Well, we technically did. We were on the same talk show with him once.
And he was an asshole.
And we were all in the makeup room, and he did not want anything to do with us. With and we anybody. Weren't even trying. No, that was the weird part. We were trying to be cool. It was the Donnie Deutsch show that... We did that never aired.
Well, that's right.
They didn't have their shit together. They were like, they filmed us 2 weeks in advance, so all the stories changed by the time they were ready to put it on TV. Yeah.
Chevy Chase wanted no part of me.
And Chevy Chase had a pink sweater on. Remember that?
Yeah.
Anyway.
No, he was. I sat behind. Oh, you were there at Book of Mormon. We went and saw Book of Mormon. Oh, yeah, he sat behind Chevy Chase.
And he was laughing his ass off.
He loved it. So.
But he didn't want anyone taking pictures.
No, he was with his family, so I left him alone. But me and Sam saw the Comic-Con that year, and we had interviewed Josh Gad from Book of Mormon, and I told him Chevy Chase. He goes, oh, tell him I said hello. So we saw Chevy at a fucking, whatever it was, at Comic-Con. So I was chatting with him. I was like, oh, yeah, Josh Gad says hello. So he's like, oh, cool, yeah. I'm like, oh, we saw you at Book of Mormon. He goes, oh, that was great. And then I hit him for a photo, and he was just like, he knew that my whole conversation was a lie.
That was leading up to the picture.
I'd never seen anybody's face change so quickly. Like, he was enjoying the conversation, and then he was like, oh, it's one of those. He got me.
Yeah.
This one person has been calling forever. We got to get them on the line.
Oh,
hi, who's this?
You know who it is. Are you sure it's me?
Hello, yeah. Lady Di.
We're talking to Aziz. You got anything?
I just want to let you know. Tell Jim Norton this. We're going to be at the show on Friday.
Oh,
I'm at the Beacon Theater with Andrew Dice Clay on Friday.
And whoa, that's awesome.
Yeah, I'm happy about that. Very cool. Be a great gig.
It's going to be an amazing gig.
Awesome venue.
Yeah, it's going to be very good.
Delighted that you'll be there.
Listen to her. She's just yapping over.
Why would you call our radio show to tell us that you're going to be at a Jim Norton show? She's one of our regulars, Aziz.
Yeah.
No. I just figured I'd call up and let you know.
Oh, why would we care if you were going?
For what purpose?
That's what he asked you. Did you see what just happened?
Thank you!
Opie goes, why would you call up and ask Jim Norton, or tell Jim Norton you're going to be at the show? And she goes, no, I just wanted to call up and tell him I was going to be there.
And let him know.
But he asked you why you would do that.
What could he possibly be doing with that information? Now he's got that info. What is he supposed to do with that?
Nothing. I'm just letting him know that I'm going to be at the show. Hi, Jim.
Hi, Di. Yes. Chanting fan base.
Marion and I are going to be at the show.
Okay. All right. That's great.
So let's take
wonderful.
This one step further.
All right.
You've told me. I've acknowledged the information. Ball's in your court.
Thank you. All right.
But what happens with that? Why does Jim need to know that?
No, I just want to let I wanted to let you guys know that I'm going to be at the
Especially
show.
Because this is like a...
What compels
is there anything
you to...
more terrifying than Norton's fans?
And she's just babbling underneath us talking.
Can you show? Can you show Aziz a photo of this enchantress that we're listening to?
Yes.
Colin, by the way, is Colin is obsessed with her.
Yeah.
Hold on.
We all are.
What?
I'm gonna change that photo. And
well,
make
it doesn't matter which one you pick. Trust me.
Yeah.
The Twitter photo is not bad, Di. You look a little tired in it, but you're lovely.
No, go to her Twitter account.
Her Twitter photo.
Yeah, where she looks like Babe Ruth,
fantastic.
If Babe Ruth is still living.
Yeah.
Oh, no, not that one, please.
Babe Ruth, when he gave that speech.
But I wish she would answer the question. I need
babbles.
To break this down. Like, why would Jimmy care about that info, and why do you have to call, like, hopefully a very popular radio show to say that?
She'll never have an answer.
Wait, let's see. I want to see the tweets.
Oh, the tweets?
Oh, they're good.
You got to follow her. She's amazing on Twitter.
A lot of responses to other people.
Yeah, she's amazing on Twitter.
Her face? Wait, let me see that Twitter pic again.
A lot of her tweets are, thank you very much. Thanks again.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which
the real
must
productive.
Be so annoying. Tweets,
I DM those
God,
tweets.
Imagine getting those, yeah.
When you text someone something, they write back, cool. Like, yeah. You wasted my life.
Pop
thanks.
That picture of her up, her Twitter picture again. She almost looks like if Sammy Hagar got stung by bees.
Oh, no.
That's a new one.
Yeah, yeah.
We got to write down all the,
something going
all the
on
people
there.
She looks like.
Ah, yes.
Of course, throw mama from the train.
My little chickadee.
No, please don't do this. No, I'm going to change that picture.
Why? It's lovely.
It's not going to make a difference.
Mitch, how did you first get into Jim's stuff? Where did you first hear about Jim?
When did I first hear about Jim?
The repeat of the question.
Yeah,
she'll do that constantly.
Hold on.
What?
I've known about Jim Norton for years.
Where did you first like see his stuff, like on Comedy Central,
God.
Or
oh
did you get a CD?
Aziz is entertained by this too.
What?
Back in the WNEW days.
When we were on the radio at NEW back in 1990.
Oh, so through the show.
Through the show, she became a fan and blah, blah, blah.
That's how both of us heard about Jim Norton.
You have a friend, Mary, and they're just...
We call them the retarded Laverne and Shirley.
I'm going deep in the hole.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I just stop now before it's like, Aziz, I'm coming to see you, too.
Oh, she'll be there. Yeah.
She'll
tweet Aziz and tell him how much you love...
She'll stalk you next. Listen, Lady Di, I'm going to try one more time.
Yeah.
You needed to tell Jimmy that you're going to be at the show. Now, what is he supposed to do with that info?
Nothing. I just want to let him know that we're going to be there. Me and Marion and I are going to be there.
Yeah, we know.
So he kind of is a show.
Marion.
Listen.
Hey, he's like, hey, you're doing the show. We're going to be there, support you.
All right.
Got tickets?
Wait, hold on. Marion does not have a MiFi.
Wi-Fi.
What's a MiFi?
MiFi is like the first generation of the satellite radio, right?
Yeah.
No.
A portable?
Yeah, a portable MiFi.
But why are you wasting our time with this?
Well, I told Marion I was going to call up.
No, that doesn't... I've never heard anybody... It's uncanny, the ability you have to relay impertinent information. I've never heard anybody with an ability to tell me such...
I've learned
nonsense.
Nothing in like 5 minutes.
Nothing.
But
Opie and Anthony, can I ask you a question?
It's like context, like we were discussing earlier, though. You do understand you're telling a national, hopefully huge radio audience this stuff.
International, Canada, too.
No one cares, but this is like a private phone call.
Right.
It's a private phone call. Oh, wait. She was trying to get a MiFi so this way she could listen to this.
And then she doesn't even hear what I'm trying to tell her.
Why do we need to hear this?
We
now
don't care if she can't get a MiFi.
Nobody can get a MiFi. They stopped making them in 2006.
Not making them anymore. Oh, all right, I understand that.
Oh.
I understand that. Okay.
Did you get a job yet? Did you get a job yet?
No.
Oh. Why?
I knew this conversation was going to come up. No, well, I did not get a job.
When did you look?
I've been looking, and I already know where to go, but I just don't bother because let's put it this way.
What way?
I'm taking a break from this job search thing.
If you only understood that deeply. She has never worked. She's been looking for a job for 10 years. She has decided to take a break from the looking for a job thing.
That's like me taking a job for being an astronaut. Taking a break.
Right.
Taking a job. Sorry, her yapping through it.
Taking a break from being an astronaut.
Wait, hold on.
Lady Di.
Wait, hold on. What?
You haven't worked in 10 years or so.
At least.
How are you?
What are you talking about? No, I did work 10 years ago.
Let's get the facts straight.
But you.
I
know. That's what I said. But you haven't.
Why
would
you take a break from trying to find a job?
Yeah.
Why do I work so hard?
Why?
Right. Like,
why?
Take 10 years off and just
and still be
do
alive.
So much
it's amazing
awesome stuff.
You could still be alive and you could still go to you could still go to see Jim Norton. Without working,
maybe,
it's amazing.
Maybe she's figured everything out.
Yeah, and we're the idiots.
We're the dummies.
Yep.
Waking up early,
yep.
On radio,
no.
Doing a bunch of stand-up.
No.
Who cares? Take
dummies.
10 years off.
And then she's got to answer. No. You guys aren't dummies.
I mean, why don't more people
thanks
do that? Where it's like, I'm just going to chill for 10 years.
Not going to do anything. Not going to work.
No.
Just going to do what I want to do.
That seems like a good deal. I'm going
right?
to chill for 10 years.
Diane, do you understand? Like, I'm not sure if you understand the dynamics of a conversation. But, like, Aziz is talking or Ope's talking to somebody, like, the sounds coming out of their mouth mean they should be entering your ears.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
you're just yapping over everybody. You're very difficult to have a conversation with.
Who are you?
wait, did you...
I don't know who he is.
I'm Jim Norton.
Jim Norton. Okay.
Oh, you know, the guy that you're going to see Friday and the reason why you called us to tell us that you're going to see him.
Do you have dementia?
Yeah.
No, I don't have dementia.
So why would you ask who I am when you've known me for 14 years?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, well, that's true, too. I'm sorry about that.
That's true, too. Holy shit.
Hold on a second.
What?
I thought maybe you had a comedian in there with you.
We do.
No, we do, and I said that as well.
What is his name?
I said Aziz. That's how this whole thing started. I said, we have Aziz in. Do you have anything to ask him?
Aziz Ansari. He's a comedian.
Okay.
Do you know?
I don't know what to say.
How about hello?
Do you know who he is?
Well, no. Well, now I know who he is.
How about you say hi?
Hi.
Hi, how are you?
All right, how you doing?
Covered that already.
Was that you, Jimmy?
No.
Oh, my God.
What are you doing?
You're a disaster.
I'm confused.
Yeah, no shit. Are you drinking
this
morning?
She's a big drinker.
What did you have this morning?
A little bit.
Oh, it's not even 10 in the morning.
Well, that's why she's giving up that job, sir. What are you having this morning?
Natural life.
No. She's drinking some natty lights, motherfucker.
Oh, wow. She's drinking in the morning. It's natural.
She's natty. By the way, anyone out there working, you're all suckers and saps.
Yeah. 10 years
and
off.
Rubes. Yeah.
Crack open a crisp natty light.
Natty.
9:45 a.m.
Oh, God.
What time did you wake up this morning? Dear.
What time did I wake up?
Yes.
Around 6 o'clock.
What time? And don't lie now. We're all friends. What time did you have your first alcoholic beverage?
Crack that first beer.
Yep.
What time?
Tell the truth.
This is my second one.
Oh, no.
Do you drink fast?
It's getting dark.
What? No. It's my second one.
How many are you going to have?
What time
today?
Did you crack it?
I just cracked it.
No, what time did you crack the first beer?
The first one? About a half hour ago. About an hour ago.
All right, 9 a.m.
You start drinking.
What
on
did
a
you do?
Tuesday.
What did you do between 6 and 9?
Well, I had to. Let me see. I washed up. I brushed my teeth.
All right, there's 2 minutes.
For 3 hours?
I was on the phone for 3 hours trying to get in touch with you guys.
Oh wow,
that is true.
So she
That's
sat.
That's why I finally took her call.
She sat on hold.
More or less.
Or trying to call in
off and on,
for 3 hours.
Just to tell... relay the information that she's going to the show?
Right. Yeah.
Now I'm not sure you have anything figured out, guy. I thought you had a whole plan worked out. For... the whole, like, 10-year breather.
She waited...
I was on board. Now I'm not so sure.
Yeah.
She waited 3 hours to tell Jimmy that she's going to be at the show Friday with Marion.
I mean, there's
I can't even wrap my head around that.
There's a conceivable reality where she waits 3 hours, calls and says, waiting for 3 hours. Hey, Jim, I'm going to be on the show. All right, cool, bye.
That's it.
And that's it.
Yeah.
It must be a wonderful thing to live like that.
Di, I got to ask you, why have you given up the job search?
Oh, no, I'm just taking a little break from it.
Well, yes, why are you taking a...
I did not give up. I'm just taking a break.
Why are you taking a break?
Because, well, let me tell you something right now. Because I'm taking a break because it seems to me like a lot of people do not want to hire people that are over 50 years old. And I'm over 50. Do you understand?
Yes.
Wow,
So taking a break, what are you going to get younger?
What was the excuse when you were 40?
Yeah, exactly.
I was 40 years old.
Oh.
Opie, you don't remember?
I don't know.
Yeah, it was 10 years ago when you were working.
What do you think people like to hire less, 50-year-olds or women who wake up at 9 o'clock in the morning and start drinking Natty Light?
Exactly. You're living a rap video.
Anthony, you got the beer wrong. It's Natty Ice.
Natty Ice.
All right, we got the natural ice.
Whatever.
Natty Ice. Natty Light. No thanks.
Yeah.
Is it a can or a bottle?
A little bit stronger than Natty Light.
Why would they?
A little strong, but good.
You got to get a little of that ice action, right?
Natty Ice.
Hey, is it a, Di, is it a can or a bottle?
A little break. What? A can.
Of course.
Slugging beer out of a can.
Just cracking that, piss-warm can of Natty Ice.
Natty Ice.
No, they're not warm. Good.
Yeah, that's great. So now, why do you think that people don't want to hire 50-year-old women, right?
Right.
But
I look like Babe Ruth.
Hey, you listen up. You don't think people want to hire, so you're going to take a break and wait for more time to pass by. That problem isn't going to solve itself by adding more time to it.
Oh, I don't know. I mean, you know, this whole thing with the computers and stuff like that, that's kind of difficult to get on a computer.
Well, you could have spent the last 3 hours learning something about it.
Right.
Yeah, I know. I have my computer.
They're not that difficult. I got a 3-year-old that's rocking the computer.
Exactly.
A girl or a boy?
Jesus.
Wait, at least you grasped the important part of the discussion.
Lady Di, listen to me. Where was the last place and when that you tried to get a job?
Family Dollar.
That's a long time ago.
That was months ago.
Yeah, whenever
Family Dollar,
that video.
Isn't that chain gone?
I think so, like Blockbuster.
I saw one of those in South Carolina like 15 years ago.
Yeah.
No, it's still there.
All right,
Family Dollar's still around? You live in New York? Family Dollar?
Yeah, she's picking up obscure places. Corvettes.
Corvettes. Klein's.
Elizabeth, New Jersey.
Elizabeth, New Jersey.
All right.
Good.
Lady Di, so you haven't looked for a job in months.
No, try 1 month.
No. When you were on this very show months ago talking about the dollar store.
Yeah.
That was months ago.
May. Rock just told me.
It was May.
June, July, August, what, 6 months ago almost?
Five months ago was the dollar store.
Remember, it was the day you had that discharge.
Die.
Yeah,
it was 6 months ago that you haven't looked for a job.
Right.
Okay.
Are you coming to the show?
Now you're making me lie. No, it was that month. It was June.
No, it wasn't.
Isn't June pretty close to May, which makes our point still?
Yeah.
It's been a while.
Certainly out of the 1 month time frame
that
she gave.
How long of a break are you going to take? It's already 6 months. How long of a break are you going to take from looking for work?
I don't know, a couple more weeks. Let's put it that way.
A couple more weeks.
And then
what a wonderful way to live.
It's amazing. She's just
God,
sipping,
I wish I could do this.
Sipping beer.
Not a worry in the world.
Not working.
Got some natties.
Getting
night
on the phone.
In the morning.
Going to see Jim Norton November 1st.
Could kill 3 hours just to tell Jimmy's that they're going to the show.
Yeah.
And you guys play, right?
Yes, lady. Myself and Dice Clay.
How are you getting the money for the ticket?
Yeah, Di, how much of the, your dad's will are you going through?
Oh, my God. Don't even mention that.
How much have you gone through?
How much have I gone through?
That was the question.
I try to keep it on a minimum basis. Let's put it that way.
By not working and by drinking Natty Ice and going to see Jim Norton.
Oh, don't forget, I'm going to go see Michael Nesmith, too, November
12th. You don't care.
She calls it every month, lets you know what shows she's yeah. going to.
She's a huge Monkees fan.
On
huge.
Oh, is that who Michael Nesmith is?
Yeah, so the Monkees. She loves the Monkees. Give us a little Monkees for Aziz so we don't feel like we've wasted his time.
What do you want me to say about the Monkees?
Sing one of the Monkees songs.
I thought, no, I better not sing that again. Let me see.
Again?
Oh, boy. Another Monkey song.
You sound like a real fanatic.
Big fan, yeah.
Walking down the street, we get the funniest looks from
bet you do.
Everyone we meet.
Hey, we're the drunkies.
Oh, you knew? Did you?
Right now, she's standing barefoot in big grandma panties with a T-shirt and a fucking beer, slugging out of a beer.
Natty Ice.
Natty Ice.
You can't get over that, right?
9A.
Oh, man.
What a life.
Over to Bud and start working for them again.
Lady Di, do you have a Halloween costume?
No. I'm the Halloween costume.
Oh, boy.
Wow.
Are you going to Anthony's party?
No, I'm not.
You are invited. You and Marion are both invited to Anthony's big shindig.
Yep.
What's the address?
yeah.
If you stay on hold, we'll get you that.
Can you call tomorrow and let us know for sure you're going?
Yeah, please.
We're not going to the party.
Why not?
Because we don't want to go.
I think I want this drunk buffoon at my party.
She'd be the hit of the party.
Oh, she would
certainly
be wonderful.
Everyone would hit her. Yeah.
All right, Lady Di. It's been terrific.
You're a delight.
You
good
are.
Good to meet you.
good to meet you.
You too.
All right. Lady Di, go get a job.
All right. Be careful.
I sure will.
You're just languishing in a sea of delusion and alcoholism.
Jimmy, I'll see you on Friday.
I know. I appreciate you coming, Di. Just okay. Stop drinking.
And so will Marion, too.
I know.
Right,
I understand.
We know she's going.
Okay.
She can speak for herself, though.
Yes.
That fucking inheritance is like a one of those. What do they call that thing? The little sand clocky thing with
the
hourglass.
The
thank
hourglass.
You. Sand clocky.
Yes.
Hourglass. Yeah. All that money. What? That her dad worked his entire life for and then, you know, passed on to another world and gave Di the money instead of, you know, maybe taking care of her son with it. She's buying Natty Ice. And,
You going to see Michael Nesmith?
He's a fan.
Jerry said goodbye.
In Englewood.
Wow, cool. That's pretty impressive.
Where are your seats?
Oh, yeah? What is Michael Nesmith going to do? He doesn't sing any of the Monkees songs.
Yes, he does.
No.
Well, he has to sing now that the other guy's
he doesn't
dead.
Sing. He wasn't the singer in the Monkees.
But the singer's dead, so.
One of them.
What?
He was one of them.
No. What songs did he sing? He sang a couple of the really bad ones that no one knows.
I know them all.
He didn't sing Daydream Believer.
No, that was Davy Jones.
Yeah.
I already know about that. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I already know about that.
Yeah, of course you know about it. It wasn't a rumor that was confirmed.
No.
She's so terrible.
All right.
I met Davy Jones years ago.
All right. I hope you meet him again. I hope you meet him again soon.
Holy shit. Oh, my God.
We got to let you go for
goodbye,
real.
Goodbye, Di.
All right?
Okay.
All right.
10:09? Jesus.
What? Wow.
It's 10 after 10.
Yeah. That went fast.
I hope you enjoyed that, Aziz. We did that for you.
Aziz. Very interesting.
Yeah, that. Colin Quinn can't get enough of her.
Oh, Colin loves her.
And her friend Marion.
Yeah, he's a bit obsessed with her and Marion.
Yeah.
What are folks?
Marion is just as trippy.
Let me tell you, that was a great call by Lady Di.
Huh?
That was a great call.
I think so.
It was hilarious. When she's, who are you? Holy shit.
That's the whole reason why you called.
Holy fuck.
And let's properly plug everything here.
Yes.
Aziz has his special Buried Alive streaming on Netflix. Starts Friday, November the 1st. And you can go to AzizAnsari.com or his name on Twitter, Aziz Ansari. And if you want to also download his older special, Dangerously Delicious. And, of course, Parks and Rec is on NBC. November 14th is when it is coming back, right? Thursdays at 8 o'clock. And this Friday, if you're not going to see me and Dice, maybe you've seen one of us recently, go to the 92nd Street Y and see Aziz give a talk.
Absolutely.
It's an amazing venue.
Thank you, man.
Thanks so much for having me, guys.
Always a pleasure.
I hope you enjoyed most of your time here today,
yes,
sir.
Yes, I did. Okay. We wanted to impress you that we get the chips on the radio show.